Welcome, everyone, to the first Board of Selectmen's meeting for 2016. It's Tuesday, January 5th, and I'd like to start the meeting, as we always do, with the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
This is the opening of the public session of the Board of Selectmen's meeting tonight. We start off the evening in executive session where we discussed strategies with respect to collective bargaining updates by the town manager relative to police and dispatch, because an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining position of the board. We also conducted strategy sessions in preparation for negotiations with non-union personnel relative to the town manager and the interim fire chief. What we're going to do now here is move to a staff recognition to start the night off. We've got a lot of folks who've been here in town for a long time who are happily for them, I think, moving along to other things. So the first one I'd like to do is recognize that after 38 years with the Hopkinton Police, Special Officer and Matron Jean Taylor has announced her retirement. Jean has served the town with true dedication in her many roles as crossing guard, traffic officer, and matron. We all wish Jean the best and thank her for her devotion to all of us and to the town. Is Jean here by any chance? All right, well, in her absence, I'd ask if everyone just give her a little round of applause and thanks for all of our lives. Jean, we do wish you a happy retirement. In the interest of time, we're now going to move along to tonight's big event, at least what I hope will be, which is item four on the agenda. This is staff recognitions. The board would like to present town gifts and recognize the retirements of Fire Chief Ken Clark, Town Treasurer and Collector Maureen Dwinell, Lieutenant Charles Wallace of the Police Department, and Town Clerk Jerry Holland. And so, so what we have here is for each of them. I'd like to read you a little bit of a summary of what they all did here in the town, and then we'll bring forward some gifts to recognize all their service. So starting off would be Ken Clark, the fire chief, the well-known, renowned fire chief in town, who retired at the end of the year after 44 years of service to the town of Hopkinton. Ken began his career as a call volunteer at the ripe age of 15 and one-half years old. He did this as part of the family business. He comes from a very long line of firefighters. Both his father and grandfather were firefighters. His brothers, Boo and Fran, his two uncles, and numerous cousins have served in the fire service. Ken served in the roles of firefighter, fire prevention officer, hazardous materials technician, technical rescue team leader, dive team diver, and public safety educator, lieutenant, operations officer, deputy chief, emergency management director, and fire chief. In recognition of Ken's 37 years of service to the town of Hopkinton and his love of the outdoors, the town is presenting Ken with a gift certificate to Cabela's, where Ken can select something special for fishing, hunting, or camping, or even for his motorcycle trip down south that I'm still envious of, and at the great suggestion of his wife, Marie. So, Ken, you want to come on up and
in his sweatpants.
I know, look at that. He can still wear the uniform, though.
Thank you very much.
No, yeah, take it to him. We'll come shake hands and get a picture at the end, so say your piece. What do you really think?
Oh, no.
You put it that way.
Have to be nice. No, I'd just like to thank, I was blessed to work for the best community in the country. From day one, never wanted to go anywhere else, never wanted to go to the city, had a chance to go there once, didn't want to go there. Chief Stewart was instrumental in opening up those avenues, and he said, what do you want to do, I'll help you? I said, I'm a Hopkinton boy, I want to stay here. And I use the saying, sometimes when you cut me, I bleed green. So it's like, it's been installed in me from an early age, the team aspect, through the sports in high school. And I was able to be involved with the best team in the world, you know what I mean? If anything that goes on, there isn't any other people in town that I would rather do anything that we had to deal with here, whether it be in someone's home, at a fire, on the highways, and they always brought their A games and made me proud and hopefully made the community proud of the job that we do and what we try to do each and every day out in the street. I'm going to be brief. Thank you very much. It's like I've been a great run. Thank you.
Thank you.
picture?
Do you want to do them all together?
Do them. Huh? I'll do it then. Okay, fine. We'll do it then.
Thank you.
Exactly. Okay, next we'd like to recognize Chuck Wallace, the police lieutenant who actually is still with us for 10 more days. He retires January 15th after 35 years in law enforcement, 30 of which were to the town of Hopkinton. So Chuck started his career on Nantucket 35 years ago, rose up through the ranks over his 30 years in town here, handling every aspect of his job, and he held every rank, including his role as chief of police. Chuck holds a master's degree in criminal justice and has countless hours of training under his belt. Chuck's been recognized by the town, the BIA, and the law enforcement community broadly for his outstanding work with the marathon and his creation of a flawless and every year well-executed security plan, which has actually been used as a model around the country and in marathons outside the country as well. Chuck's been commended on many occasions throughout his career for acts of bravery and exceptional performance by the town of Hopkinton as well as by outside agencies. And in recognition of Chuck's 35 years in law enforcement and his love of fishing, Dottie, who was always thoughtful, came up with, I hope, will be a particularly useful gift for Chuck this year. So, Chuck, come on up here and get your gift here. Have to read just to get it right. It's a St. Croix Mojo surf spinning rod. Very specific gift. All right.
Don't break the top.
First of all, I'd like to say it's an honor follow Chief Clark. He's been one of my great mentors over the years I've been here in Austin, so thank you very much. I'm trying to put a few words together, and there's only two words that that come to my mind. I, as you all know, I probably have a lot of words, but the two foremost are thank you. First of all, thank you to my family. I'm sure a lot of people can tell you it's tough being married to a cop. You know, you miss a lot of events in their family, and hopefully now that I'm going to be retiring shortly, I can make up those missed times. I also want to thank the Board of Selectmen and all the townspeople. I came here 30 years ago, and I was still kind of green. I was here for about 15 minutes, and I said, I'm going to make a home here. You know, I was honored and blessed to be working with some great members of the police department, who are true friends of mine. They were great mentors. They helped me grow up from a free auxiliary police officer in the late 70s all the way up to interim police chief. Without those great members or mentors and supporters, I wouldn't have been able to do that. So I want to thank the Board of Selectmen, all my friends and family on the blue team, as well as all the community people that have stood by me and supported me over the years. So again, thank you to all of you. I appreciate it.
It's been amazing. It really has. Tonight's next recognee is Maureen Dwinell, the treasurer collector, who retired at the end of the year as well. And as only the town accountant or a town accountant could do, Maureen has described that she has worked for us for 26 years, 8 months, and 8 days. So it's not specific. So Maureen's been a long-term selfless, dedicated servant to the community, including a lengthy tenure on the Board of Selectmen, actually, 6 years, five of which she was chair, for which I feel deep pity. She did her time in all regards. Maureen's time in government also included, she was a state-elected member of the Metropolitan Planning Organization, she was co-chair of the Central Mass Transportation Authority, and she was on the board of directors of the 495 Metro West Partnership. Well, Maureen said her heart's always tied to Hopkinton. She and her husband, Red, did sell their home and on College Street several years ago and bought a larger farm right down the street here in Upton. Maureen, actually having retired, is going to work with her daughter, who is in town at 77 West Main Street in Hopkinton, and lives Salon, helping her with the financials over there, and is also planning to spend more time with her family. Our gift for Maureen tonight, in recognition of her 26 years plus of service to the town and her love of antiques, is to present her with an antique dome-top trunk that was helped to buy by Judy of Country Plus on the recommendation of Maureen's daughters, Cindy and Jen. So there we go. Store your paperwork in it.
Full of cash.
Something only a treasurer could love.
Very nice.
First of all, I want to thank the selectmen for all their kind words. And I'd like to thank the community for allowing me to serve them for the 26 years, 8 months, and 8 days. I've had a great ride. I've been involved very much with the community. My heart is always with Hopkinton, born and brought up here, and especially to the community and the people that I've worked with over the years. They've been great. Couldn't do it without them, and I'm going to miss it. And I want to thank you. Thank the Board of Selectmen. Thank Norman, Maria, and the community, and all my friends here tonight. Thank you.
Okay, and last, but absolutely I don't think any of us would think least, is Jerry Holm, the town clerk, who retired on December 31st, just shy of 20 years service to the town of Hopkinton. So Jerry has been town clerk for almost 3 years. She actually moved over to the assistant town clerk position in 2012, and she's held many jobs here in town. She was operations assistant, as many of you may know, for many years up in the selectman's office, executive assistant, administrative assistant, actually for 16 years, working with many of us on the Board of Selectmen. She also did an interim term as the parking clerk, where she got to deal with all manner of reasons for why people had to come in and get their parking tickets waived. Jerry has received a number of awards, including she was recognized by the state of Massachusetts as an unsung hero for her dedication to the town, and just recently was recognized by the Housewives of Hopkinton also for her service community. Jerry's always been a vocal advocate, supporter, and volunteer for Project Just Because, for the Serenity House, for the Michael Carter Lisno Respite Center, and intends to continue to support those organizations through her dedication to the arts. And in recognition of Jerry's long-term service to the town and her love of those arts, the town would like to give Jerry a gift certificate to the Blick Art Supply Site, as recommended by Brenda McCann, to let her continue to work with and support these organizations that are near and dear to her heart. So, welcome, Jerry.
We're doing heads first.
Exactly. Thanks, Ben. Yeah, I have to head first.
Kenny did.
This could go on for an hour. Can't do everybody right now, Jerry.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I like to hug. All right, she knows I got a wicked cold. Okay, it's true, like as Maureen said, it's the community that I love, and I'll always want to serve the community any way that I can. And yeah, I spent most of my tenure with the Board of Selectmen, and I served under every single person here except for John. You were the other day I got from the housewife, so that was really cool. And Mr. Kamalo, it's been a pleasure working with you, and I'm glad to see you. I remember being here in this room when you were interviewed, and you were definitely my number one choice, just to know. Yeah. HCAM, I love you guys. Everybody here, I think, just to know just about everyone here, the police department, wicked awesome in working with them through the years. Fire department and DPW, actually. Sarah from the Independent. I you hate missing anybody. There's people out here in the hall. I love all of you. I will see you on the trail. I'm going to build a big nest, and we're all going to nest in there, and we're going to have fun.
Take a nap
when we need you, okay? And Bob, thank you so much for all your support, too. So, thank you. I appreciate this greatly. I'll see you around. And one more. Brenda, my assistant, who is now the acting town clerk. She's wicked awesome. I have every confidence in her. It's true. So, thank you.
Thank you, Jerry.
Have them all sit on the bench.
That would be standing would be awkward.
The only one would be able to see. Chuck and Kenny up there as well.
The only person who said he'd be able to see would be mine. All the rest should be sort of out in front.
Just like real quick from far.
Jerry, can I stand up there?
They can all see.
All columns in the back.
Except they said the only person who said he'd be able to see would be mine. All the rest of you are too tall. You know.
Everyone's tall. Everyone's in the back of Jerry. He's talking about himself. He's standing on the bench.
Okay.
Well,
I get on the back. You're not getting on the
back.
Come on,
hey,
Jerry.
Hey, I'm on this one.
All right, let's see some love right here, please. Just for a moment, then you get all those others. Another one right here. All right. Walk right here.
Okay. See you around town.
Okay, now it's back to work.
Exactly. Now it's a long downhill slide to adjournment.
Pretty much. And the fun continues.
Okay. Feeling ebb in the force. All right, having done that, we'll pick up here with the agenda item. Usually we start the meeting with public session. We'll start that now with the public forum. Residents are invited to share ideas, opinions, or ask questions regarding town government. So would anyone like to come forward and speak at the public session?
I would.
Please. Just come on up. Name and address.
Yes, Sandra Safaro, 132 Fruit Street in Hopkinton. I am here representing a number of Hopkinton citizens bewildered by the selectman's decision not appointing Steve Slam as permanent fire chief. You appointed a search committee consisting of a town manager, an HR person, a person from personnel committee, fire chief, and selectmen. 18 interested people applied for the job, and the committee spent many hours narrowing the finalists to two individuals. One finalist withdrew, leaving Steve Slammon, remaining finalists of who should have been appointed permanent chief. Points of interest of Hopkinton is a very fast growing town. Hopkinton is larger in area than the town of Framingham. Hopkinton has several unique issues other towns do not have. It is a home of liquefied natural gas facility. Hopkinton is the starting point of the annual BA Marathon. Hopkinton Fire Chief serves as the emergency ambulance services coordinator for this event. As a past chief since 1970, all have extensive training to meet state and federal guidelines and certifications. Acting Chief Deputy Steve Slammon has served this town for many years in the capacity. Many letters to his credibility has given testimony to that. Why should there be any further discussion towards this appointment?
Anybody else?
Good evening. My name is Jim Pine. I live on Pond Street, and I've lived here all my life. I have both an interest in and a connection with the Hopkinton Fire Department. When I was born 73 years ago, my father was the fire chief, had been for a number of years, was until his death in 1964. In the last 50-plus years, we've had five fire chiefs that took it from a volunteer fire department to a fine professional fire department that it is today. I read where you've decided to appoint Steve Slammon as an interim chief. I heard and read about the process you went through rightfully when Kenny gave us notice. You went through a process, you appointed a committee, they did your job, and they made their recommendation unanimously. I've known Steve both personally and professionally for a lot of years. I can't imagine a more qualified guy. Of the five fire chiefs in the 50 years, four of them grew up in this community, grew up in the fire service, and each one developed the fire department to what it is today. I think you're remiss to appoint Steve as an interim chief. I'm urging you to reconsider and to appoint him as a permanent fire chief going forward. Thank you.
Tom McIntyre, 29 Pleasant Street. I would like to say I'm in support of Steve Slammon to be permanent chief. Like Chief Clark had said, the Hopkinton Fire Department, you can put him with anybody in the state, and I'll back that up with him anytime. So I definitely think you should make that choice tonight to make him a permanent chief. There's no reason not to. I don't know what reasoning you have that you want more than one choice, but in this case, I think you have somebody that you will not find a better person than Steve Slammon. And I'd also like, while I'm here, I'd like to thank all the retirees for the service they've done to the town. Thank you.
Anybody else?
My name is Tom Terry, Maple Street in Hopkinton. Gentlemen, thank you very much for your service. I have one suggestion. When it comes to later in the evening, when you're discussing the protocol as to what we're going to do going forward with appointing an interim or a permanent chief, I agree with the previous four speakers, and I'm pleading that you at least bring it up for discussion. I know there won't be any public input, but I think it should be reviewed in your minds, and I think I'd like to see a show of hands of the people in the room that came here in support of Steve. Could I do that, Mr. Chairman? Thank you very much.
Thanks. Anybody else? Okay, one more.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Patrick O'Brien, 13 Ray Street, Hopkinton. First thing, if I could, I would also like to thank our retirees. Every time I came up to the town hall, always met at the Selectmen's office with a big smile from Jerry. Very helpful. Maureen's always been that staple down in the treasurer's office. Lieutenant Wallace, had the pleasure of working him with 30 years. Came over from the island via Upton and made a house, a home here in Hopkinton. And Chief Clark, what can we say? Born and raised in Hopkinton. Started as a call firefighter. Raised up the ranks from a call man to a firefighter to a lieutenant to a deputy chief to the chief. No ambition to go anyplace but here in Hopkinton. Kind of sounds familiar. Kind of sounds familiar to me. Sounds like Steve Slammon. Those of us that got to know Steve realize his love is here in Hopkinton. He's not going to be a stepping stone. He came up as a call firefighter to a regular firefighter to a lieutenant to the deputy chief. If I could, without offending anyone and on the board, I've had the pleasure over my 32 years of working in Hopkinton of knowing many, many boards of selectmen. Some that call themselves Democrats, some that call themselves Republicans, males, females, people that were in Hopkinton for their lifelong, new residents of Hopkinton, independents. The board has been made up of all different types. And I'm sad to say that I never felt as disconnected with a board of selectmen than I do with this board right here. I've been a town employee for 32 years, town resident for 25 years. And I feel no connection with this board of selectmen. As a member of the Hopkinton Police Association, we've had events. And sadly, I haven't seen a lot of members of the board there. I've been to other events in town. I have not seen members of the board there. I feel that this board, for whatever reason, whether it's intentional, whether it's your personality, whether it's the new town government we have with the town manager, that you've stepped back from getting to know town employees and the town residents. And I think that's a mistake. Because if you took the time to know the town employees, to know the resume of Deputy Slammon, to know his love of the town, his love of the police fire department, you'd realize that he indeed is the best candidate and the best person for that job. Thank you.
Hi, Sandy Altamira, Elm Street. There's a lot of things I could say, a lot of comments, I won't. I do have one question first. The search committee that you had, I assume that you gave them a parameter to work with, did they not follow it? Did you tell them you expected them to narrow it down to one or two candidates, or did you want to see all 18? Did that committee fail in its duty? That's one of my first question, if you could answer that.
Go ahead, get them
all. All right, the second question is there any kind of monetary amount that goes with this kind of a search? Is this free to the town, or do we have to pay to redo it? Mm-hmm. So those are my two questions. The only comment I am going to make is I think that there's a great outpouring of support for the man you've decided to make the interim fire chief, but I feel that this town runs on volunteers. We ask our volunteers to do a lot. You put together a committee and you've thrown away all of their work. I think it's deeply insulting to them, and I think it's deeply insulting to the candidates. I think you've made a mistake. I think you should step back and say you made a mistake and just go ahead and appoint Steve as the permanent fire chief.
Okay. Answers to your questions. What happened with the committee? The committee was charged with bringing forward a number of qualified candidates to the board. We were very clear we wanted multiple candidates. What happened at the end of the day was, through a number of reasons, we ended up with one candidate. It's the candidate you all like. It's the candidate we like. But it was, in fact, at the end of the day, one candidate. And again, that's because, frankly, at least two potential finalists dropped out of the process right at the very end of the process. The board sat here the night that that happened and said very clearly that this is not about the qualifications of Deputy Chief Slayman. I want to be very clear about that. This is about the fact that we have put in place a process in town and we expect this to operate every time we're doing a significant hire in town, and that is we want to undertake a broadly executed process. We believe it's important for the board to have multiple candidates to look at in each case because of the fact that in all these jobs, these are very significant positions where people are going to be for us for a very long time, and we have a community that's undergoing a lot of growth and a lot of change, and we have not shown any concern with being just stuck with anything that's already in place. So this has nothing to do with the qualifications of Deputy Chief Slayman or our views of him or whether or not we'd be happy to have him as the next chief. This has entirely to do with the fact that we believe that we've put this in process in place for good reasons, and it's important to execute this process. So the fundamental answer to your question is no. The outcome of the process as was executed was not what we hoped for and was certainly not what we desired. And so the board has indicated a desire, and we'll talk about it again, as you may well know, at 8:50, to execute the process to get to that, to have that opportunity to evaluate multiple candidates. And again, this is for the benefit of the entire town. Second question you asked was about the cost. Did we have a final accounting for what the last search cost us?
Yes, the town paid for the posting of the position in the Boston Globe, and the cost of doing that was approximately $3,000. We have not accounted for staff time. All the interviews were conducted during the day when nobody would be at work. We were also blessed with the assistance from two town volunteers. They did not charge the town for their time. In addition, we also, through mutual aid and through our local networks, received assistance from a local fire chief. He did not charge the town any money. So far, what the town paid for was advertising and posting the position in the Boston Globe, and that amount was approximately $3,000.
And then final comment with regard to your concerns about the time of the volunteers and everyone else's effort, let's point out that everyone sitting here at this table is a volunteer. We have great respect for everyone who gives their time and their efforts to the town. We all are searching for the same end game. All of us in this room live in this town and want to be the best place possible to live. So there should never be some assumption that we just cast this aside because we're somehow detached from everything and it doesn't really matter. We're all looking for the same outcome. I understand, I appreciate, I respect the fact that all of you who raised your hands earlier want to demonstrate that you disagree with the outcome of the process. But the fact of the matter is, we regret that. We'd rather not have that be the outcome. But we think it's very important for the good of all the town, for now and in the future, that we do these processes in a thoughtful, rigorous, and sort of long-term concerned manner, rather than just going with the simple answer. Sorry, is my microphone not on? Oh, okay. Maybe I'm just talking too soft. I talk too much, my voice is getting lost. There we go, so good. Okay. So again, we're going to talk about this in a few minutes when we look at the interim chief's contract. We're going to talk about this again at 8:50. That's really more of a board discussion, but obviously everyone is welcome to stay and hear more about all this. Does anyone else want to come to the podium and talk before I move along? I'll raise my voice. I'll drink some water.
Mr. Chairman, Bob Levinson, 13 Smith Road, Chairman of the Search Committee and former Chairman of the Personnel Committee. Just two comments. We have open disagreement, which I appreciate and respect. And just, I do think it was a thoughtful and rigorous process, as we said before. They said that we had committed to only presenting qualified candidates, people who could do the job, and we said unanimously that these were the two who could do the job. So that's just, I just want to make sure that's on record. Secondly, we chose to come to Hopkinton 16 years ago for a number of different reasons, and hearing tonight openly and what's been going on in the comments and everything, it just makes me really, really appreciate the town. Dale told me I still am not officially a townie. I have to work towards that, but I just think this is wonderful, and it just makes me really appreciate the town here, so thank you very much.
Last chance. Okay. Item 5 on the agenda is a consent agenda. There's a couple items tonight. First minutes, the board will consider accepting the following public session minutes. July 14th, 2015, August 11th, August 31st, September 15th, October 20th, November 3rd, November 17th, December 1st, and December 15th of 2015. Item 2, gifts. The board will consider accepting the following gifts. $200 to the Parks and Rec Commission to establish a Claflin Memorial Fountain Maintenance Fund for the purpose of general maintenance, care, and custody of the Claflin Memorial Fund from the Hopkinton Historical Society. $200 to the Historical Commission to establish a Train Depot Maintenance Fund for the purposes of general maintenance, care, and custody of the Train Depot from the Hopkinton Historical Society. And $20 to the Hopkinton Ambulance Fund from Plura Bosconi. Does anyone want to break out any of those items? Okay. Mr. Kamalo.
The minutes, I'm requesting that the board defer any action on the minutes.
Okay, good. All right, we're off to a one-item consent agenda again. Thank goodness. All right, Chair, I'll entertain a motion to approve the gifts to the town.
So moved.
Motion.
Second.
Second. Further discussion? All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Present, not voting. That's unanimous. The gifts are accepted. The minutes will be taken up at the next meeting. Item 5 on the agenda. It's Town Manager and Interim Fire Chief Contracts. It's an action item. The board will consider approving Town Manager and Interim Fire Chief Contracts. Taking the town manager contract approval off the agenda tonight, there's just an administrative issue we need to fix. And so we'll do that at the next meeting and have a final approval of that. So moving right to the interim fire chief contract, the board previously, based upon the outcome of the next meeting, the board negotiated a contract with Deputy Chief Slayman to serve as interim fire chief in Hopkinton. Deputy Chief Slayman has agreed to that contract, and the board voted earlier tonight in executive session to approve the contract. So what I'd like to do now is get have a discussion about approving that contract in public session.
So through the chair, I'll make a motion to approve interim fire chief contract for Steve Slayman.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Do we have any further discussion? All in favor? Go ahead.
Chair, I will make a comment that this board would not appoint anyone to interim chief that they didn't think could do the job.
Okay. Well said. Anything else?
Can you repeat that?
I said this board would not approve anyone to the interim chief's position they didn't think could do the job.
Okay. Further comment? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Present, not voting. That's unanimous. So the interim fire chief contract is approved both in executive session and public session. Item 6 on the agenda, board appointments to the Irvine-Todaro properties. It's an action item. The board will consider appointing candidates to the group. First, a representative from the Parks and Rec Commission, second, a representative from the Board of Selectmen, and then three at-large candidates. Ms. Kamala, would you, can you tell us about the where the Parks and Rec and, department stands?
Yes, I did receive an email this afternoon from Jay Guelfi, the Park and Rec director, advising the board that the commission selected one of its representatives to join the committee, and that representative is Dan Terry.
Okay. Good. And then with the three at-large candidates, my device here just bombed out. Here we go. So do we have all three candidates in the room tonight? Gail Carey? Gail here? Donna McKenna. Is Donna here? All right. And then Patrick Sansonetti. No Patrick either. Okay. So, okay. So we have three candidates for three at-large seats. The board can discuss that. We have Dan Terry proposed by the Parks and Rec Commission. as their candidate, and then the board also needs to decide who would be our representative. So with that, going over to Mr. Herr.
I may have missed something, but I see
two more.
Five or six.
Oh, did I miss the last?
Nancy.
What the heck?
So we have Gail.
Oh, Nancy
Carey,
Burdick. Sorry.
Donna McKenna, Patrick Sansonetti, Nancy Burdick, Alton Chen.
Totally my mistake. Nancy Burdick.
Gendron.
Alton Chen. Right. Daniel Gendron. Are any of those folks here tonight?
I'm sorry, Kathleen Teague.
Kathleen Teague. Is anybody from that group here tonight? Okay. Ms. Kamala, do we have how do you propose we make this great selection with no candidates? Does anybody know any of these people?
Given the fact that we have multiple applicants, the board should consider postponing appointing the at-large members, but proceed with appointing the representatives of both the Board of Selectmen as well as the Park and Rec Commission.
Does anybody have any objection to pushing this the at-large to the next meeting so we can bring these ask these folks to come on in?
I do not.
Okay. No complaints. So we have Dan Terry to discuss, and then we have a Board of Selectmen's candidate. So let's go to the second part first. Would anyone from the Board of Selectmen like to be part of this endeavor?
I would.
Mr. Catino would. Okay. Would anyone else like to be competing for this? Okay, sensing no competition.
I got the Pratt farm. I'm good.
Yeah, you already
got
one.
The school
got
committee.
I'm
working on land. In the school building committee.
Okay, so John has graciously offered to be the member of the Irvine-Todaro Property Committee from the board, and we have Dan Terry proposed from the Parks and Rec Commission. Chair, entertain a motion to appoint those two folks to the Irvine-Todaro Property Committee.
So moved.
Do we have any further discussion?
Can I vote?
Why not?
Okay, just want to make sure.
You're not excluded from voting.
Okay.
All right, all in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, present not voting. That's unanimous. So both those folks are appointed. The three are large candidates. Mr. Kamala will push this to the next meeting and ask them to come on in to meet the board. Give everyone a fair hearing. Next item on the agenda is liquor licenses, 2016 changes in hours of operations policy. The board will review hours of operation policy for restaurants and related establishments and then consider approving 9 licensee requests for a change in hours or other aspects of the licenses. And I thought what we'd do tonight in the interest of time is actually do the second part but not the first part. So recall the last meeting, right at the end of the year, we had a number of liquor licenses we had to renew. We had 9 people that asked for changes in their hours, some longer, some shorter. What the board decided to do was just in the interest of time to approve the licenses as so they could take effect on January 1st. And then we said we want to come back and think about this policy and then decide how to treat these hour changes, basically by giving people a window and letting them make their own decisions. I think that's probably still a valid concept, but having done some work on it, I think the town manager has advised me that it's going to be a somewhat more complicated process, and so it's really not ready for tonight. So I think the thought was that in the interest of letting these people go forth, the board could discuss the changes that are asked for in the licenses, decide whether we're going to make those, and we'll do the policy as sort of more of a long-term thought plan. Mr. Sistar, yes?
Yeah, could we enlighten this to the complications? Because it seems to me easier to have a single discussion rather than multiple discussions.
Well, one example is malt beverages, all alcohol, and wine and beer licenses all have different attributes. And so it's a question of do they all need to be different? Do they all, right? So that's just one example of some of the complexities. So also, there's a number of, as we all talked about before, different establishments in different areas of town. We may not want to treat all areas of town the same. And so there's a little bit of granularity involved in terms of how we think about downtown versus over by 495 versus over in East Hopkinton. So the idea is to do this once and have it be fully baked as opposed to doing this and then having to go back and redo it just because we're trying to get it done quickly. Unsatisfying to you, I can tell. But it was not going to be ready for tonight if we did that. To do that was not going to be able to get done tonight.
The
Mr. Kamal, I'm sorry, I'll come to you, but do you have any further clarification on what I just said?
Yes, there's another logistical issue the board needs to consider. If the board is going to propose any policy changes, there's a requirement for a two-week notice to anybody or any establishment likely to be impacted, and the board is also required to hold a public hearing.
Likely to be negatively impacted?
Likely to be impacted.
So what's considered impacted? If someone currently stays open till 10, and we say they can stay open till 11, is that impacted?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I don't agree. Because they can still close at 10 if they want. But I just get tired of kicking the can down the road, and let's have a conversation later. And it just seems we're gonna have a more painful discussion taking each one of these separately. But if that's what the board feels.
Well, just to be clear, we don't have to. We can actually approve them. We can just approve the licenses as requested.
That's just my opinion. And, I mean, are there legal considerations other than you know the two-week notice for impacted business?
I think the other legal implication is the very issue that we have three different classes of licenses. There's the pouring license. There is the common victualler's license. There's also the package store licenses, as the chair alluded to. Each of these have different thresholds. And in fact, within that is the fact that the board has discretion on at least two of those three categories. The board does not have discretion on the package store license hours.
Thank you.
Mr. Catino.
Yeah, I just see simplifying it. You know, I grew up in a town where all liquor stores closed at 11, all restaurants, the licenses ran out at 1, but everybody else, you could close any time earlier that you wanted, but at least the public safety personnel knew that if somebody was open past 1 o'clock or if a liquor store was open past 11 o'clock, that there was an issue. And there wasn't, oh, this person's 10:30, this is 9:30, this is an 11, or we're on this side of town, it should be a little bit different. It's just to level the playing field for all the businesses and level the playing field for our safety personnel. That's it.
Mr. Marger.
I'd like to see some data to kind of shape this. I mean, we all, even though the town's growing, want this town to remain to keep the best parts of it, I guess. And I guess some input on how, some information on how these times may affect the character of the town, maybe in an appropriate way or maybe in a way that we don't want to. I feel like right now we're just kind of guessing at what might be the right time. So I don't know where we get that kind of information. Mr. Kamal, would you have any input on that? Maybe Chief Lee would, if there's a correlation between opening times and disturbances or noise complaints, that sort of thing, and then we could kind of narrow down what it is we want, kind of how we want to shape things versus just reacting to this.
Okay. So do I hear that folks would actually rather not do these tonight and come back with a revised and have a larger discussion?
I would rather not. I feel like I need to have some backdrop against this. I mean, we know what we had before, and mm-hmm. that seemed to work okay. This is different. Maybe it's different and it's okay, but, or maybe it's different enough that it's going to kind of pull us away from the character we're trying to maintain. But I don't have information to drive that decision. I'd like to get some information.
Okay. I think,
go ahead.
If I could, the combination of the data request along with Mr. Catino's idea of some kind of consistency for the various types of licenses, mm-hmm. Maybe if the data could feed into that consistent policy, it would make the most sense.
Okay. So just to be clear, so no one wants to take up these items tonight and make these changes?
I don't.
Okay.
Is there any business that really needs this and needs our action immediately? Is there anyone called to say, I need this right away?
By and large, these are relatively small changes.
Yeah, I'm looking at Maria, and she's nodding her head. I don't believe we have had any requests.
Okay.
They needed the answer right away.
All right, so we're going to put this on the agenda for a larger discussion.
Great, thank you.
As quick as we can get it done.
I think you just wanted to get back on schedule.
Do whatever it takes.
Are we there yet?
Okay, so we're going to revisit that one next time. We have a posted public hearing in a couple minutes, so while we wait, why don't we go through liaison reports? Ms. Kama, actually, do the, we got 2 minutes.
Do the name.
Pardon me?
You can do the name, maybe. What name? Street name.
That's not always as quick as you think.
Number nine?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we've been known to bog down on street names. All right, let's do it, though. We'll give it a shot. So item number nine on the agenda, Mass Department of Transportation street name approval. It's an action item. The board will consider approving a street name for the Massachusetts Department of Transportation Service Center on Wood Street. The names suggested by the proponent are, in order of preference, Leo Stevens Way, Macadam Road, and Grace Ave. At the risk of going down a very deep rabbit hole, would anyone like to
I'll make a motion.
To discuss?
I'll make a motion to approve item number two, selection two, Macadam Road. Macadam
Is
Road.
Is it Macadam Road?
Macadam Road.
Right. Okay. So we have a motion.
I'll second it for discussion.
We have a second for discussion purposes. Okay, so we have a motion and a second to approve Macadam Road. Mr. Hurd, do you have anything you want to say?
So whether it be Macadam Road to the motion or the other two, what is the significance of the names and why is the proponent, the Mass Department of Transportation, putting those forward, do we know?
Well, because it's going to be that road that goes up toward the Mass Pike.
Do these names have anything to do with Hopkinton? Or is it just the DOT coming and saying?
I'm aware of no background that was provided. I think they just came forward.
And then last question, Mr. Mosher, why did you choose number two?
I didn't like number one, and I thought.
But you don't know who number one is.
I don't know. I don't know. It just doesn't roll off the tongue. And Grace Ave, I thought sounded too nice funny. To be spent on.
Department of Transportation.
Yeah,
exactly.
So there you have it.
All right. Admitted logic, thank you.
All right, good.
Or lack thereof.
So we have a motion, we have a second. We can always kick this back for further
There's
elaboration.
Logic there. Maybe a little twisted. But.
All right. Mr. Catino, any?
No, I'm good with it. I'm
good with Macadam, because you seconded it. Of course you are. Okay. Mr. Sestari.
Who's going to be the caretaker of this road? Is it the Department of Transportation, or is it Hopkinton?
It's not a public way at this point, to my knowledge.
It's not a public way.
Okay. To my knowledge.
So my only concern with this would be if Leo Stevens is, in fact, the godfather of the Mass Department of Transportation, and we deeply offend these people by doing this. Having no background, do we have any insight as to the rationale behind these names?
That information was not provided to the town.
Right. Okay. See? The simple things that always get you, John.
Oh, it's true.
Okay. And we have no comments from anybody else, so there's no conflicts that would point us toward an obvious solution. You're currently Googling Leo Stevens.
So Leo Stevens, it appears, is a retired Northeast Transportation Technician Certification Program, so it must have some significance. It doesn't appear to be the only thing that may have been the
He's already got some
executive board.
Rights going on. Well, fair warning was given on this agenda.
I did, in fact. But then I went for it. That's all my fault.
Whether it's the same Leo Stevens or not, I don't know.
I'm going to table this while Mr. Mosher does further research, and then we'll come back afterwards. That's all right. See? It's my own fault.
Sounds very similar.
Is the motion and the second withdrawn?
Yeah. We're going to sit on this. Chair's going to table this because I have to open a public hearing anyway. No, well, you can't. I got to open the public hearing anyway. So, so the hour being 8 o'clock, we do have a posted public hearing for Bill's Pizza, all alcohol license application. The proponent is North Series Corp., DBA Bill's Pizza 7 Restaurant, locations 14 Main Street, Hopkinton, Mass. The board will open a public hearing to consider approval of an application to alter a Section 12 wine and malt license to an all alcohol license. The applicant's also proposing an alteration of premises. There's a number of attachments, including a notification. Chair will entertain a motion to open a public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Motion second. All in favor of opening the public hearing, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, present, voting. That's unanimous. The public hearing is open. Sir, well, gentlemen, welcome. Come on up and introduce yourselves, please, and tell us what you want to do.
Okay. I'm Zach Siarkos, one of the owners of Bill's Pizza. And I'm Stephen Zeef, petitioner for the applicant.
Fresh out of witness protection program, clearly. So, okay.
Thank you, sir.
Good.
We're here. We're petitioning to change my wine and malt beverage to an all-alcohol license.
Okay. And are you also, we guys have scaled this down once, and so you're also proposing a alteration. And I know what it is, but for the record, can you just tell us what you're proposing to do?
Sure. We're going to enlarge the bar area, and we're going to be closing in the patio or deck in the front of the building.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, for the record.
Please.
As we understand it from when we first applied for this, the alteration of premises has been a long-standing issue.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the questions that have been raised by town council, we thought were prima facie to the file. And we're happy to illuminate on any of those things that you'd like to go through with us. But we actually were here to discuss, you know, because we were under the impression the town was already aware of all the other things that had transpired, including that alteration of premises, which was a matter of record.
Right, but I think you have to get it done as part of the change. You know, have to get it approved as part of the license change.
Correct.
The alcohol. That's the issue. So it's not a. This is not a permitting issue, really. This is just a acknowledging that you're going to do it a different footprint, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Good. So anything else to tell us before I go to the board?
Okay. Would you like us to go through the matters that were raised by town council, or what's your pleasure, sir?
Sure.
So we were appealed to this this afternoon. So section 11, I'm just going to take the town council's items down the list. Section 11, the individuals listed in section 10 have an existing interest in a current license. It was our interpretation that they were asking whether the applicant had an interest in another license elsewhere. So we want to make it clear that the NSARIS Corporation is the existing licensee under the wall.
Stephen, not to take a giant step back, but just because you kind of came out of the blue sky, what is your role here? What's your affiliation?
My affiliation is I've been friendly with these gentlemen for a while.
Okay.
And they asked me if I could help them work this through the process, understanding that it was a detail-driven environment.
Okay.
And here I am.
So you're just here in an advocacy role. You're not a
that's correct.
You know, partner or something. Okay, fine. Thank you. Sorry.
I just didn't
understand.
Okay. I think we all. I think everybody, like you said earlier, everybody's volunteering their time in a variety of ways. And while I'm here in a professional capacity, it's
okay. Keep on going.
Interest. In our answer to 16E, we specifically say to be determined because until such point in time as the applicant has the right to purchase alcohol, there's no way to figure or scope what the actual purchase will cost, and that's why we honestly put in the answer to be determined. Our answer on 17, we say out of the entity would be out of existing cash flow, so, and we don't think we break the hurdle, so that's why that's. The corporate vote was dated the same date as the application, which is December 9th. And we trust, based on the capacity of this board and others, that the floor plans that we've submitted are fairly straightforward. We also would respectfully submit that they also demonstrate, in some respects, that the alteration of premises is rather insignificant.
You good? Okay. All right. Over. Mr. Sestari, do you have any questions?
I guess one of the things I'm wondering is with these types of licenses, is there any automatic assumption or requirement of, I guess, food to alcohol ratios in terms of sales and things like that? I like Bill's Pizza.
Thank you.
I like what it is for the community. I enjoy being there. I like seeing, you know, all the soccer teams going in there, the basketball teams, baseball, you know, it depends on the season, right?
Right.
and the kids going in there on half days and things like that. And I would find it hard to believe that part of your business model is to convert it more into a bar than as opposed to a pizza place that serves some alcohol.
Sure, that's a good one.
But it's at the same time something that I'm afraid of. So I'm just wondering, are there any restrictions that come with a license like this or that can be attached to a license like this so that we can be more reassured that, you know, we're not laying the groundwork, even if it's not, you know, with your license, you know, if there's some eventuality of it being sold, you know, where we get into a spot where we're creating more of a bar in the center of town than a restaurant. That's what I want to avoid, I guess.
If I can add anything to that, I'm not planning to change my hours much. I'm not going to be open till 2 or anything. Maybe Friday and Saturday might be till 11. That's the idea. So I don't want to change the atmosphere of my place. Hopkinton is a family town. You know, that's been our business for 15 or so years. So no, I think that would hurt me anyway to change into a bar. I don't want that.
Yeah. You know,
so I think that's in our control as much as possible to really control what kind of atmosphere you have. You know, if you allow people to act as if they are in a bar, then it will turn into a bar. But that is in our hands, and that's not what we want.
Okay. Good. Ms. Coutinho.
Yeah, that was actually my only concern is that it still stay a family restaurant, but there are many family restaurants in town that do have full liquor licenses. So if it's if that's still in your business model, because I think it's a great destination. It's one of the crown jewels, I think you can say, of downtown. It's the only constant. I'm just looking forward to be open a little bit later so that when we leave Town Hall that we actually have a place to get a bite to eat, because we start here sometimes at 4:30. So I have no other questions.
Okay. Mr. Mosier.
So other restaurants have this type of license in town.
Well, alcohol?
Do they not?
I think they all do.
Right?
Yes.
So I think to deny it, that would put them at a competitive disadvantage. I think we're all pretty astutely looking at the alcohol situation in town with some new restaurants coming in and things like that. But I think we should consider it. Quick question for the police chief. Chief, do you see any difference in alcohol-related issues between, you know, establishments that are beer only versus all alcohol?
My experience here in town, no, I haven't seen that. But my experience in the previous job, most definitely came to the amount of alcohol, straight alcohol being served.
Through the chair, I did notice your comment asking if there would be a requirement to buy food with the alcohol. Would that be something that, you know, you folks would do, or
that's actually
a way to do that?
Yeah, I don't know if I can put a requirement like that, but that's how it would benefit my business. You know, when somebody sits and eats and has a couple of drinks or a beer or whatever, that's the idea anyway behind this.
I'm good.
Okay, Mr. Herr.
So why do you want to do this?
I see the town growing. I think alcohol is a way to attract people for a night. For example, let's see, tonight, it's a very quiet night. I think if a young couple, I have a lot of friends in this town that are young, either very young kids or not, don't have kids yet, and want a place to have a meal and a drink that's close and most of my customers ask for the same thing. To mention, we actually had a, we thought it would be a good idea to kind of see how many people would be interested in this. I have a petition, actually, of just people that signed that thought it was a good idea. So I've had a demand for it. And I feel like it's a good step for our business, you know, and the town's really growing. There's a lot of, there's more restaurants coming into town. I think it would help me.
Okay. So is this the appropriate time to talk about how serious we take these licenses and the activities that go on inside the establishments?
Why don't we do the hearing part first, close it, and then when we deliberate, I think that'd be the proper time to bring it all up. Does anybody have any other
questions? Yeah, I do have one other question. I'm looking at the proposed layout, and, you know, it has one area that says bar area seats. I guess where is the delineation of where minors will be able to sit versus not sit? Is it just, you know, the legality of sitting at a bar, or is it going to be this, you know, this section of seating?
Right, it's more going to be, yeah, one side and the other side, yeah.
Okay, so there will be a side that's the bar, and the other side is for...
Correct, yeah.
Okay.
It's the part two, I think, the part two of the licensing. It's like the very last page. Okay. There's really two parts here. There's the alcohol license, and then there's the alteration of premises. And the alcohol license, I think I'm probably fine with. The alteration of premises, so your proposal is, and I'm just having a count while I do this. So you, right now you have two, like on the left side when you walk in, you got two booths, and then you got a six top, and then you got a four top, and you got a bunch of kind of seats over there by the window.
Yeah.
And you got the kind of little bar that kind of arcs around that has, according to this drawing, six seats.
Yes.
But what you're basically going to do is get rid of virtually all of that, and you're going to have instead 3, 6, 12, 15, 17, 20 or 21 seats around a sort of octangular bar area. So all that seating that currently folks can sit at to have meals is going to go away, and it's just going to be basically a bar with the bartender standing inside it.
Actually, I'm going to have the same amount of seats. The booth will still be there. It's just going to change location. The booth that you're referring to when you walk in on the left, it will go to the back wall.
The back wall where the bar is now?
Correct, yep.
So that shows me...
That booth will still be there.
Well, that says... I'm not you know, being argumentative, but that shows like two small, like side-by-side tables at the back.
Yeah, it's the same exact thing that's up there, the high top. It's a big booth that stretches all the way across the back wall. And then there's two four-seater tables in front of them. And then there's 21 seats around the bar. And the gain in the bar seats is from the closing of the deck, which are 12 seats right now that sit out in the deck, which I use, I don't know, 3 months out of the year maybe.
Yeah, I get it. And that becomes, but again, this picture must be wrong. I don't see the big six-top you're talking about. Like, my picture doesn't show the big six-top. My picture just shows... No, that's current. That's the current setup. The new one is this revision. See,
I haven't.
And this new. No, go to the next page.
I tried.
Oh,
mine's not even opening.
I had to go. See. I had to go to the thing and open
the next page. For
yeah.
Me.
So.
Right. So
mine. Yeah, mine has this blue circle.
So you're looking at it this way. Okay, all right.
Now
so.
I got it. So I must be missing it because what I see in the back is like I see the kind of oval bar. In the back, I see what looks like kind of tables with two seats side by side facing. Facing toward where the TVs are now, I guess. And then I don't see any kind of a six-top.
So
I don't have that in my...
Let's explain it this way. All right, so let me see what you have here. Right. Okay.
Way to throw it up.
Should I come up and...
Yeah, sure, yeah. Come on forward, just for the sake of simplicity here. Yeah. Do you see where I'm lost?
Right. So this is the booth that is right now here, which will move back here. It's the same booth.
No, I don't deny it. I just don't understand it.
So this is a wall here. The kitchen is all behind here.
But when you say it's the same booth, it's not, because the booth is this, right? It's this thing, which has a table and then the seats, like that four seating for four next
that's
to
not,
it.
The tables are actually turned the other way.
Oh, so this drawing's not the right
it's
thing.
It's just, yeah, they're just turned differently. And it's one
does it look
long
like this?
Bench seat
does it look
here.
Like that, basically?
No, it looks like...
It's a bench seat facing
correct.
Forward.
Oh, yeah, it is a bench seat. I was just, yeah, I was just sitting
there. So you're just saying, okay, so I get it. So this is wrong.
So that coming over here.
So you're getting rid of this, the six top.
Yep.
That goes away. The four top really gets turned into a bunch of kind of twosies.
One. Yep.
And then this thing goes away. That goes away, too, because that becomes a bunch of those two seats.
Exactly.
Okay. But folks, families or kids or whatever won't be able to go back there to
we'll
use it.
Be on
right?
the other side. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Does the license stipulate that? The bar area is not for minors under 18 or 21?
Well, did we do that for 110 and some of the others?
There's a state law.
Quattro's the same thing.
So is the bar.
We've never done that for a license. To my knowledge, we've never done that for a license.
I mean, okay. by state law, they can't sit at the bar, but these other tables off to the side here, are you going to have kids there?
I'm going to mostly have, you know, that side will be the family, kids-friendly side, and the other side will be the bar side. So definitely not at the bar. Now, I don't know about the high tops, you know, if it's that booth that we were just talking about, if it's a family of four.
But it's not going to be separated either, right?
Sure.
You're not going to make that wall go to the ceiling, so it's still going to be that half wall, right? So the whole thing's still a big open area.
There's a 5-foot wall, and then there will be a plexiglass another 2.5 feet up from there. Either side will be open.
Between the sides, but not between the bar and those tables, the high tops.
Right.
Like Fridays in Milford, you've got the bar, and then you've got those high tops there. They're right in the same area.
I've never been to. Okay.
How about families who are in the family section? And they're having some pizza, and the parents want a drink. Do they have to go to the bar and get
yes,
it?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, so it's not going to be wait staff.
No, it's not changing. No.
Okay. I'm not crazy about the layout. Does anyone on the board have any questions for the proponent? Mr. Kamal, you have something, a statement?
I think given the board's interest in the food issue as well as the question from the police chief. And this is not intended to further Mr. Cortina's interest in having food after meetings, but specifically, what time does the kitchen close?
Right now it's 10 o'clock.
Okay.
And the kitchen will mainly close at 10 o'clock regardless of the license, the liquor license. I will still have, you know, finger food is the idea at the bar. It won't be a full kitchen.
Okay. Just wanted to confirm that.
No, thank you.
And again, that'll be, I don't know, 2 days a week, maybe Friday and Saturday.
All right. Okay. Are we allowed to vote this issue with liquor license and alteration separately, or is the alteration tied to the liquor license?
Tied to it.
Because it goes to a footprint?
Has to go to a footprint.
Yes, because the footprint of the license is based on the footprint of the plan.
But is that a square footage or is that a layout? Is that
no, in terms of layout.
So the actual layout is what has to be approved?
Yes.
Okay. Anyone else on the board have any questions?
Well, I haven't spent a lot of time considering the layout. For some reason, I don't have it in my file, so I couldn't see it before we came in here.
Okay.
I think from a philosophical standpoint, they've been a good business in town for a long time. Just seems kind of inconsistent to leave them at a competitive disadvantage because they were here.
Right. Well, that's a deliberation. I'm just trying to get questions done. So
no other questions.
I guess I'd just like to know. I mean, I'm and maybe you already brought this up, Mr. Chair, but I'm counting seats here. In your mind, what's the number of seats in the dining area versus the number of seats in the bar?
Let's see here. So the bar will have 21 around, and I have 15 right now at the bar. So I'm taking the seats from closing in the patio up front of the deck. Those six basically are being added to the bar. Seats that before I only used 3 months out of the year, I'm adding them to the bar. So everything else, basically, the numbers are the same.
But all those seats, there's 21 around the bar.
Right.
But then there's all the seats that are still in the bar area.
Sure.
So those, in my mind, are still bar seats.
Okay. 2, 4.
6.
We got 16.
I
think my count was something like 37.
10, 12.
versus the restaurant area, which I think comes out to, let's say it's six people 36. Per big booth. 40. 1, 2, 3, 4, 24, 30, 32, to around 36. So it's about 50-50.
50. There's about 50 seats on that side. So those are all six tops, except for the first one?
Yeah.
So you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
How many?
Seven six tops.
Okay, I wasn't sure up by the window if that was one.
And then one four top.
Space.
So it's about 46 or so seats over there.
Okay.
Okay, please continue.
So, we're all talking about laying out your restaurant, which is the people we have to be careful. Did you have any architectural input, or did you just lay
yeah,
this
no,
out?
Yeah, no, I didn't draw this.
I thought I'd make sure that, here we are. One of the things I think we have to keep in mind, maybe we should save this for a comment area, is that I was just thinking that when I go to Quattro, they have the deuces on the side, that when it's crowded, I go with my daughter or something, we end up sitting adjacent to the bar. And it's the same thing when we go to the Thai restaurant. That's all anybody of us can sit is adjacent.
When you're done.
Adjacent to the bar. So, as we're counting, thinking that the people at the bar will be negatively impacting the family people. We're still a family town with family people going, I think.
Can I get a sidebar here just one quick
second? Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Oh, thanks. I keep losing my little piece. Okay, fine. Other questions?
Any members of the public? I think we're ready to close.
Yeah, I was going to go to that. Yeah. Do we have any members of the public, abutters, who I noticed were not properly notified as part of this? Anybody else wish to make any comments? Okay. Seeing no abutter questions, last chance for anyone on the board to ask questions before we close the hearing, move to deliberation. Okay, seeing no questions, Chair will entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Motion second. Further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, present, not voting. That's unanimous. The public hearing is now closed. So now it moves to deliberation by the board. And so again, the question at hand is to whether or not we care to approve the change in the alcohol license to all alcohol, and tie with that whether we want to accept the... their proposed layout, the changes the bar area. Starting off with Mr. Mosier. There you go, sorry.
Sure, I need a piece of candy, I'm afraid to.
And I got
a call on me.
I'll take a pass for now.
Okay, Mr. Mosier's gonna take his turn later. Mr. Sestari.
I'm in favor of the liquor license. I guess my preference would be to see a different ratio of bar seats to dining seats.
Of course, yeah.
With it being fewer bar seats to more dining seats, but I'll say at the same time that I'm not opposed to families sitting at the tables around the bar. So, I mean, that alone probably levels it out. So I guess that's my main thing.
Okay. Mr. Herr.
I don't have any strong feelings one way or the other with respect to the layout and the expansion of the dining bar area. The patio, while it's nice, I don't think it gets used very often. I'm good with all that. My concern is going from beer and wine to all alcohol. Throwing a couple shots down is a lot easier. And if you have inexperienced waitstaff or an inexperienced bartender and they're not picking up on somebody doing something like that, it's hard to throw down three beers, but it's easy to throw down three shots of tequila. So the board takes alcohol, our responsibilities in the community, and with respect to alcohol, very seriously.
We've had a recent incident that resulted in suspension for several days, which is a loss of significant business, sort of as a penalty, if you will, for some poor judgment on an employee's part. And I just want to express that again here tonight with respect to you going from the beer and wine to a full all alcohol, if that's what the board decides. Okay, well, you get it past the first time you make a mistake, or maybe the second time will look the other way. There's zero tolerance for inappropriate behavior and zero tolerance for infractions. And throwing it right on the table, it will cost you money if we mess it up. So please keep that in mind. Make sure your staff is trained properly.
Sure.
And if there's a problem, we're going to come have a very serious conversation.
Okay. Over to Ms. Catino.
Yeah, I actually want to steal a little bit of Mr. Mosier's thunder when he said, you know, that Bill's has been here for a long time, and I just hate to see putting them at a competitive disadvantage with another restaurant coming down just 50 yards away, and then another one going down near 495, and having them hang in there with everybody else getting the full liquor license. It just seems like it's a fair thing for us to do. And like Mr. Sestari said, you know, I'm comfortable with sitting family adjacent to the bar, so I'm fine. But take it, it is a serious change, and TIP certified.
Correct.
Yeah, go on.
Just like to make one other comment in relation to the layout. At first, I think, you know, your answer about the bar area being just bar, no one under 21 going into that area, I think that was the answer that I was hoping for.
Yes.
at that point. As I think about it, though, apart from the ratio of kind of dining seats to bar seats, I also think that allowing an integration of the families who choose, you know, to sit at a table around the bar also makes it less of a bar, you know, as opposed to, you know, here's where all the drinkers are going to be sitting and here's where the families are going to sit. Just a final thought.
Well, so to that point, I look at it and I'm not wild about the layout. I kind of like the patio, but I know it, you know, most, you know, for a good part of the year, it's not productive. I kind of look at that and I kind of feel like it is a little bit of that's where the drinkers would hang out. And that's, but there's not a lot of space in there in the interior in total. So I'm not really prepared to sort of start managing the layout to get the social effect that we want. But I see your point also.
Well, and to your point, not to try to manage someone else's business like we're going to do right now, but you know, on a Saturday with 15 soccer games going on in town, all letting out at the same time, and everybody, going in a wave down to Bill's Pizza, I would imagine that keeping everybody on that one little side is going to be difficult, you know, to say the least. Just finding places for people to sit.
It's going to come back to how they run the business and how serious they take their responsibility and the atmosphere that they want to create in that business. You know, if they're not worried about the atmosphere and they don't take their responsibility seriously, something's going to happen and they're going to lose the license. It's as simple as that. If they do it responsibly, and I think they run it the way they've been running it by and large all these many years, I think they'll be fine.
Okay. I mean, as for me, I'm fine with the all-alcohol license. I get it. I mean, you're a restaurant. You know, as you can probably sense, I'm not that excited about the layout. I think it is going to turn into sort of a more bar-y feel. It's almost starting to look like two different restaurants, the pizza place to the left, to the right, and the bar to the left. So I don't really like it. But having said that, it's probably because it's the most, by far, family-friendly place in town. And so it's right. It's been a place you can bring a lot of groups to. And I think that's going to change. Having said that, I don't dislike it or think there's enough reason to not go for it, and I guess at some level the market's going to decide. There's more restaurants coming to town, and if people like other places better, they'll go there. So, I mean, it's your business to run, and I don't know that I have any real good rationale for why I'd oppose this. So that's sort of why I come out on this whole thing.
Is it in the request, or I guess maybe tied to this layout, that it's only 21 and older on that left side?
No.
Okay. So that's just self-enforcement.
Yeah, the idea for us was that we wouldn't allow only kids to sit over there.
Okay, fair enough.
No, as I said before, you know, if a family comes, I'm not going to tell them that. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't sit on the side.
Okay, I didn't hear that part.
Yeah, that was the idea.
Okay, great.
Okay, but just to clarify though, you're not going to have anybody actively telling people they can or can't go somewhere, right? I guess if you see kids walk in and go to the left, you're just going to throw.
Right, I'm not going to allow, you know, 5-6 kids to sit around the bar.
And when you're not there, like that'll be a policy of the place, so you'll tell people not, you know, unaccompanied kids don't go sit in the
correct
even in the old patio area or something.
Right.
Okay.
Mr. Chair, will you entertain a motion?
Please.
So,
Mr. Kamalo.
A couple of administrative issues. One is that the application came in with a request for a waiver of the fees. In the past, I think the board has been pretty clear in terms of applying its fee policy, but most importantly, making sure that we...
Was it for a waiver of the fees or a credit of their prior fee toward this?
Right. Because we just got approved.
Yeah, so they just paid $1,200 for the current license.
Right. Yes.
And they just want to apply that $1,200 to the $1,800 for this license.
Right.
So the net is $600 more.
Yeah. Well, let him get it out, and then I want to revisit that. Yeah.
Yeah. It's up to the board to decide on that issue. The other piece that I discussed preliminarily with Steve is how we handle the requirement for applying for the alteration of premises aspect. Again, it's a matter that the board may decide to act on today, or you may decide to require that application go through. But I think also as part of that conversation, the board may want to hear directly from the applicant how they would like to proceed. The reason being, this application will be forwarded to the APCC. The APCC in the past has kicked back applications that don't have that application specifically.
Can you revisit that second part again, Mr. Kamalo?
I think this is the application.
I think I'm as confused, you know, everybody else seems to be as confused as I am.
Yes.
So,
nice work.
There are two components to this application.
Right.
There's the application to change the alcohol license to an all-alcohol license.
Okay, right. We can skip over that part, right. Alteration of premises is what you're talking about.
Exactly.
Right, and that is...
And the issue for the board is whether the board feels at this point that you've received sufficient information and you believe that the notice that was provided adequately advised the public that the premises was going to be altered.
Oh, I see.
If the board is so inclined, then the board could act. However, that conversation must also include input from the applicant, because this application is going to be forwarded to the APCC, and the APCC may kick this application back to the town, requiring that a specific application process for the alteration of the premises be completed.
Through the planning board and all?
I mean, through this board.
Through the board of selectmen?
Yes.
Okay. So do we have to refer... I'll come in a second, John. I want to see if I can generalize the question. So, do we need to affirmatively decide this, or do we just have to take that into account when we decide that... Is that something that you just on the board has to think about as they decide if this is sufficient? But we don't have to make an affirmatively decide that was executed, this public process.
But if we don't, then the application for the license, for the alcohol license, goes to the ABCC and comes back.
Maybe.
In other words, there's no point doing that if we don't do the site. Right?
Yeah, so what you're saying is we have to do the site at the same time we do the alcohol license, which is basically what I said before.
Yes.
So we could actually split it out. You're just thinking it would be not advisable to split it out.
Exactly. And in terms of timing, action could be taken tonight, or it could be taken at a later time. However, that decision must include input from the applicant.
Decision on which part? The layout plan or the okay. So we couldn't. So what I asked you up front was actually right. We could split this up. We could say support the license, but not support the not necessarily yet approve the change of the alteration of premises.
But that's going to stall.
I understand. That's just going to make it come back, right? So okay, Mr. Mosier, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to.
Just a question for the applicant. So I think generally the board is okay with the idea of the alcohol license. Would you be amenable to revising the layout to try to do something more family friendly, or are you steadfast that this is the layout you want to have?
Well, we already spent some good amount of money with the architect that did the building actually to draw up this layout. We feel that this is the best choice. I'm not sure how we could adjust it to make a bar more family friendly, because I don't think it's the bar itself is a family.
Understood.
Type of thing.
Okay, you're good.
Good. Yep.
Okay. Can we come back to the fees now for a second? Go right to the money. So let me just say what I think I heard, and then tell me if I'm wrong. So you, December 31st, we approved your license for this year. You pay $1,200 for license renewal.
Correct.
To do the, which you've already paid, I assume. That check better have cleared. Okay, so in conjunction with the change in the license, you would need to pay, under the new license, you need to pay $1,800. Is that what I heard? So what you're just asking us to do is credit the $1,200 you already paid against the $1,800 that you'd pay if this was in place, as opposed to making you pay a whole new $1,800.
Correct.
Am I spot on? Mr. Kamal, was that accurate?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, everyone agrees. Okay, I just want to make sure I understood that. Does anybody else on the board have any questions about any of that? So let's start. So we got a couple things we got to do. We got to decide if we want to approve the license without the alteration of premises. We have to decide if we want to, which would just end up meaning it just comes back to us. We won't have to decide if we'll approve the license with the alteration of premises, which is probably the applicant's desired route. And the simplest pathway forward. And then corollaries to that the corollary to that is to decide if we are willing to waive the fees. But again, that can be a separate thing we can decide after we decide whether or not we want to go for the license. So with that having been said, you, Mr. Herr, are going to
make a motion.
Yes, so I move option two.
Option two. So the chair will entertain a motion to approve the application for the all alcohol license and with the alteration of premises and to forward it to the ABCC.
Second.
As submitted tonight.
I'll second
a motion
that.
And we have second. A second. Motion second all over the place. Ms. Kamal, did you hear that?
So
I figured. So the motion on the table that has been seconded by the board, and I just want to make sure we're doing what everybody wants, and so Stephen needs to listen too, is to approve the application for the all alcohol license in conjunction with the proposed alteration of premises to forward to the ABCC.
And there was a second.
And there wasn't, so, okay, you got that?
Did that include the necessary input from the applicant specific to the, or have we, I think we've already got that input from the applicant specific to the alteration of premises, correct, Mr. Kamal?
Through you, Mr. Chairman.
Please.
First of all, the application is checked off as for the alteration of premises. And we appreciate the fact that the deliberations that you're taking here. The matter, as we said earlier, we think is covered by what's gone on so far. I would say that we had 155, because of our location here in town, we have 155 certified letters that went out. All right. And I don't think anybody here came in response to it. And I think that the issue of whether the notice has been effective or not is an issue that is the applicant's risk, not really the town's. If it gets kicked back, then we've got to go through the process again, or we have to amend it. We have to notify it again. Based on the rousing turnout we have here tonight, I'm not necessarily sure that anybody really cares all that much about
it. So just so the board knows, just so we can be, I'm not going to take a vote on whether we think everyone was formally notified, but let's just talk about the evidence. So there was a newspaper notification that was published as required for public hearing. There was a public hearing. There was a legal notice that was published. You sent 150 certified letters to all the abutters in the property. Mr. Camallo, did the applicant perform all the standard activities we expect someone to perform when they're coming forward to us for a proposal that requires a public hearing in terms of notification? Is there anything they didn't do? That would be standard. No, that would be a normal course action to take.
I think Jamie went down the checklist and The applicant did fulfill all the.
Okay. Does anybody on the board have any concerns about whether or not everybody, all the interested parties were properly notified?
I do not.
Okay, fine. So I think we're good on that front. I think the board has duly considered whether or not that was done, and I've heard no concerns raised about whether or not we have issues. Okay?
Thank you.
That makes sense, Mr. Kamal? You look at me like I did something wrong.
No.
Okay. Okay. Good.
It's the normal look.
Mr. So we have a motion to approve the application with the alteration of premises as proposed and to forward to ABC. We see we have a second. Do we have any further discussion on this? Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, present not voting, that's unanimous. Okay, go forth and prosper.
Are we going to discuss the license fee?
Yes, we are going to discuss the license fee. So now the question is, as we talked about before, they've also requested that we waive the license fees. You heard my explanation. The question is to waive or not to waive.
Make a motion that we waive the initial $1,200, because it's fair.
Credit.
Yeah, should we say credit maybe? Should we say credit the previously paid fee for this year? What if the chair entertains a motion to credit the previously paid fee for the fiscal year, for the calendar year, right? 2016 renewal against the fee that will be due in conjunction with the revised license and all in premises.
Well said, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, so is that your motion?
My motion.
That's what I thought. Motion, second?
Second.
Second?
Second.
Further discussion? Mr. Camallo, please.
It's an additional amount.
Yes.
Yes. So, that's what I was trying to. We
so the town cannot really pay that as an allowance. I just want to make sure that whatever amount is waived is only
right. So what if the motion was amended to waive the town's portion of the $1,200 fee previously paid?
Credit.
Appreciate it. Friendly
credit. Amendment. To credit the town's portion of the fee previously paid.
That's my motion.
That's the amended motion. Is the second okay with that, Mr. Hearn?
Yep.
We're good? You understand what we want?
Absolutely.
Just pass the money. That's what we want. Okay. Are you good with that? Does that make sense to you?
That makes sense. I just had one comment.
Please.
The application was filed in December, and I think that, you know, as I guess some type of policy, to me it seems like this makes sense because they did file the application prior to the end of the last license, and this is more of a procedural thing that they were trying to move forward. I think that in the future, the board should consider if somebody came in on January 1st or January 2nd and filed an application in that situation, then you're out of luck.
So no gaming the system is the key point here.
Exactly.
Okay. Any other comments? All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, present not voting, that's unanimous. Now go forth and prosper.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you all for your time.
Okay, back to what's turning out to be tonight's most interesting event, which is the street name approval, which we previously tabled. Mr. Mosier, your further research indicates
that Leo Stevens does exist, appears to have some affiliation with Transportation DOT, Executive Board for some sort of training.
Okay, so the board has been advised of the great importance of this gentleman to the transportation network of the state, if not the country. We have, however, on the table a motion to second for Macadam Way. Would anyone like to discuss this further?
Did anybody second Macadam?
We did have a second.
We did for discussion purposes.
Sake of discussion.
Well, I have no emotional attachment to Macadam Road. If somebody feels that, Joe Stevens may have great attachment to.
I'd like to propose Lebowski Lane.
Okay, board's getting punchy. So, two choices here. If we're worried about offending the DOT and getting tickets for the rest of our lives, we could go back and ask them for further detail. Otherwise, we do have a motion second for Macadam Road, which again was indicated as a perfectly acceptable choice for them. So,
is this in any type of historic area of town? This is what, a connector to the pike or something?
If you go left, like right across from the recycling center, you kind of go up the road, you never go up, it goes to the pike.
Okay, so that will.
I think it's a Papagino's up there or something.
Yeah, exactly.
So I would encourage us just to go with their first choice if no one has a strong opinion. So we have a motion and a second. Just take the vote, but I'd encourage my colleagues not to support the motion, and then we'll take another motion. Right?
Okay.
Well, I don't want to do silly votes if no one's going to vote for it. I mean, I don't want to do Macadam Way. Let's pick the right
one.
We
could just take no action. Mr. Herkin, I like motion.
I like Macadam better.
Probably, I'm probably more in favor.
Grace
of that
is actually my favorite of the three. But.
Grace is your favorite? Okay. So we've got none of the above. Okay. No, we have a motion. We have a second for Macadam Road. Let's vote it. Okay. So all in favor of naming this new street Macadam Road, say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed?
Opposed.
No.
President not voting. Thank God I don't want to abstain. That'd be awkward. So it's 3-2. By three to two vote, the most contentious issue we've had this entire year, the board votes to name this road Macadam Way.
Says we're always unanimous.
Okay.
Oh, goodness.
All right, item number 10, annual town meeting calendar. It's a discussion item. The board will review the annual town meeting calendar. Mr. Kamalo.
Yes, I'm requesting the board postpone this discussion. I still need to sit down with the new town clerk to go over the calendar.
Okay.
We had discussed this previously with Jerry.
Okay, we do have to pick up the pace on this, right? We're starting. I mean, I'm starting to get anxious that we're falling behind schedule. I mean, we haven't even got a budget coming together yet that I've seen. Item 11, fire chief posting. It's an action discussion item. The board will discuss the reposting of the fire chief. So last meeting, the board heard the recommendations, determined to negotiate a contract with the interim chief, which we approved earlier tonight, and at the same time asked the town manager to take action to reconvene a committee to commence another search. While we had the interim chief. And so effectively the proposal here was to take a dual path process, negotiate with the interim chief, which has now been completed, to have him take the role of interim chief and allow him to get moving on the job and hopefully putting his name back in the process the next time. While in the interim, we would also, concurrent with that, get their committee restarted and repost and move forward to determine if there's any other candidates out there that we can identify and bring forth. Does anybody want to revisit that decision?
So we have definitively named Steve Slammon as the interim fire chief.
Correct.
We have directed Steve Slammon to act as the fire chief, and I think that's a clear distinction that people need to understand. We've not asked him to just keep the seat warm while we figure out what we're going to do next. We've asked him to run the show. And we've directed the town manager to begin the process, at our last meeting anyway, we directed the town manager to begin the process to move into another search process, mm-hmm. begin the process to start another search, correct?
Right. Correct.
Through the chair. So, Norman, where are we in that process that we initiated at our last meeting?
We have the information required to post the position. We also are open to any suggestions from the board, from the public, in terms of where else we could post. And in view of the resignation of the chair of the personnel committee with immediate effect, which we learned last week, We need to go back to the personnel committee to seek their representative on the search committee. Similarly, tonight I will be requesting the selectmen to confirm the board's representative in the selection committee.
Okay.
So, I mean, my question last week is similar to my question this week, last meeting is similar to my question this meeting, with a very specific set of directions to Chief Slammon for tonight going forward, and with the process that Mr. Mosier and others sat through or went through in the second half of the year, last year, do we expect and can we expect a different pool of candidates? That's what it's all about. If we're going to go through the same process, get the same 18 applicants, I mean, that's fruitless, right? So I'm just trying to figure out what is our expectation of this process. Should we go again? Is it going to be of value?
So I would say three things. First of all, we said up front and we said consistently we want to have multiple candidates to evaluate. We think we owe that to the community to actually say we went out and we looked broadly for candidates and we had choices and we selected, right? So there's just a faithfulness of a process that we've put in place that we've used for every other significant hire in town, whether the police chief a couple of years ago, whether the town CFO process, whether, you know, any of these jobs that we appoint, we've done that. We've consistently said we're going to look broadly for candidates because we believe we have great candidates in town, but again, we owe it to the community to do this in a rigorous way. So that's the first step. Second thing I would say is history has taught us that, in fact, no two processes are ever the same. We ran the CFO search, Mr. Kamalo, three times, if I'm not mistaken, to get a candidate, right? I mean, twice we came up dry and actually had no candidates. Not this current one, but in previous searches. So I have in my tenure seen that the applicant pool change dramatically from one time to another, because things just happen, right? People are in and out, whatever stuff happens. I mean, again, let's remember, we had a number of candidates last time that were moving their way to being final candidates, and then at least one of them exited the process 2 days before we made the announcement to take a job in Westboro, right? So people come and go. And then the third thing would be, again, I guess my fundamental question, who are we hurting by doing this? You know, Chief Slayman's in the chair. He's moving forward, right? We've made it very clear to him that should he choose to re-enter the process, this is a great opportunity for him to run the department and start displaying his traits, right, in a positive fashion. I fail to see who's being damaged by this. Anyway, that's my analysis. Anybody else have any comments to make on that?
I don't believe you. You fail to see who's been damaged. This man has been damaged.
You know what? This is not a public hearing.
Good night.
Okay. Anybody else have any comments?
So if we're going to repost, I would suggest that should returning applications resumes that pass review and phone screen, should they actually warrant a personnel committee, I would suggest that two members of the board are on that committee.
Okay. Okay, so that's your proposal, is we amend the committee and appoint two members, not
right.
Just one.
Should we have applicants that we believe are qualified enough to reform the committee,
mm-hmm.
and we may or we may not, that we have two members of the board on that committee?
I'd just like to make a minor modification of that, because I don't want people to think that the board is trying to take control of that search committee. Certainly not opposed to two people being there from the board. I understand where you're going with that, but I think only one of them should be a voting member.
Okay.
and the other.
We have not disbanded that previous committee, though, have we? We never voted to disband it. So that committee still, it's the life of the project.
Sort of ad hoc, yeah. Right.
But they're all sworn in, aren't they?
Well, they don't really get sworn in. It's a group of already appointed people who just sort of act as a committee. So it's not an entity we created. It's, like I said, sort of ad hoc.
I guess from my perspective, we don't want to confuse the community, nor do we want to confuse applicants, right? So that's what I'm, or potential applicants, if that's what we decide to do. I'm just trying to make sure that we don't create this quagmire as we move forward. I think being very clear that Chief Slama has been named the interim chief, but has been directed by this board to be the chief and not behave like an interim just to keep the seat warm. I think that's very important, not only to Chief Slama, but to the community, that is the directive. But then if we, you know, through the obligations that we feel that we have to the community to get a thorough search process complete, and we don't feel that that's complete yet, we don't want to create some confusion.
Right.
I just want to figure out what's the best way to articulate that and act on that if that's the case. I don't have the answer. I'm just throwing it out there.
Okay. Over here, anybody? Nothing. Okay. So I don't know that I hear any desire for any change. I think I hear questions about what's going to happen, but I think you just have to.
I mean, my
only, I don't know if you can know if it's not priority knowable.
My question would be, does the board want to specify a number of applicants, or a minimum number of applicants to be, forwarded along to us? Are there any other specifications that the board wants to make, right, so that it's abundantly clear what the intended applicant flow looks like or quantity?
That's, well, again, I'll compare us to police chief, where we had at least five, I think, candidates to evaluate, right? Which maybe we don't need a five, but I think you want, I mean, I forget who said it, but the last meeting we said we want multiple, right? We want a number, a choice, a obvious, so, a, an
so
actual
through,
choice.
So through the chair, the police chief process, we received many more than five resumes, but we narrowed it, the personnel committee narrowed it down to five that came before,
right,
the board.
Right.
I would hesitate to put a specific number to it, because in my opinion, only candidates that the personnel committee could envision taking the seat in Hopkinton should come before the board. And whether that's two or whether it's four, the number shouldn't matter. It should be based upon whether that candidate could actually perform within the town.
Well, but again, how does that determine? I mean, I guess I worry that we end up with a group that's sort of making our decision for us, right? By under no criteria deciding that this is sort of what happened, right?
So
what sort of happened last time is the group
correct.
Came forward and just sort of pre-decided for us, which was not what we wanted them to do. We wanted them to, right? And so I like having some number of, and I would also frankly say that if that had happened with the police chief search, we might have had a different outcome, because we would have had more. What they did is they conducted a base level of interview and then put them through some third-party testing, right? And then all those people came forward to us to decide. And there was a group that was not excessively winnowed. I worry, again, about...
So actually, yeah, the group does make decisions. Everybody that came before the board for the police chief was qualified to be police chief in the town of Hopkinton. There were other applicants that the committee deemed were not.
So...
Right.
So,
but then the final round interview process that we all went
that's
through,
that's up to the board to
take into account, the personality of the community, the personality of the applicant,
right?
The 300 people we know are going to be saying one thing about the applicant, the 300 people we know they're going to say something. The personnel committee's not going to know those things that we know are representing the entire community.
Right, that's
we get input
that's my
everybody
concern.
And their brother,
right,
and sometimes their mother too. And no one else gets that, and that's our job to bring that into account. And that's what didn't happen in this process. Because we had the applicants bail in the last minute, we kind of got stuck holding the bag going, okay, well, how are we going to compare and contrast the applicants against the community and what we know about the community? That's the piece that I struggle with and where I think why we're stuck in this quagmire.
So through the chair, so what you're saying is right. The personnel committee could have picked somebody a third person or even fourth person to put in front of the board, but it, in my opinion, we wouldn't want to put anybody in front of the board that wouldn't be qualified. To Mr. Herr's point, it's up to the board to determine out of those who best fits the community and the board's expectations, but I don't think somebody should be in front of the board that that isn't qualified.
Let me go this because I'm turning to the right, I'm not talking to anyone else on the left.
With all due respect, I would have liked the chance to do some comparison. I know Deputy Chief Slayman's background, and I know what he's good at. I've seen him in action at Golden Pond and at other sites, but I didn't have a chance to see another resume, another person, or anything else. And so, you know, if it would have been it would have been very easy, you know, black and white, I think, for the rest of the board to just look at another resume and say, oh my God, this guy's not even close, as opposed to getting no choice at all. You know, he's a great standard to live up to.
So through, but through how the do we chair, know? Mr. Kamau, were any members of the board excluded from information about this hiring process?
Any members of...
Well, where are you going with this? Hold on, John. Where are you going with this?
John said he didn't have any opportunity to review...
Well, no, I think what John meant was, you know, he would have liked to have seen more candidates. I think fundamentally at the end of the day, what we felt like was we got a candidate, and we had said very upfront, very, very much early on, we wanted candidates. And so, but again, it didn't work out that way. Lessons learned. Communication imperfect, right? Blah blah blah. It almost doesn't matter. What I want to focus on is the only reason I want to talk about any of that is to the extent it influences where do we go from here. And I don't know that any of it does. This is not about casting blame, looking for failures. This is about here we are with the process. We said last time we remain committed to evaluating candidates, and so the agenda item is to talk about. How do we do that? And by the way, we already set the town manager forth in the process, and so it's really it's more about do we want to just keep on doing what we said last time to do and pick a selectman to be a part of this going forward.
So as part
let
of
me
process,
go to let me go to Todd. Todd hasn't had a chance. I promise I'll come back to you
my
next.
Question answered. I just wanted to.
But I think I'm not sure. I'm trying to keep the conversation moving forward. I'm not sure. Well, go ahead. But I'm not sure it helps.
My point is that going forward, we should ensure that any of the selectmen have access to the applicant information.
That's fair.
And can sit in on right. interviews. I mean, right. it's just exposure to right. Mr. Catino's point.
Thanks.
So I'm wondering if part of this next process, you know, and I'm just spitballing here, but do we want to go through a process where we get the pool down, or, you know, this committee gets the pool down to X number? I don't know if it's 5, 6, 7. Those 5, 6, 7 go through the process at the assessment center. And then from there, the top 3 scores, 4 scores goes through the next set of interviews with that personnel committee to make the more fine-tuned group that comes to us. That way, we're at least using the assessment center, which is more of a professional organization. It's a professional assessment of firefighting, you know, and firefighting management and capabilities, as opposed to a group that's primarily composed of lay people trying to evaluate who would be a good fire right. chief, where those people, they know the community, but they don't necessarily know firefighting. Or firefighting management.
So through the chair, the assessment center compares candidates. The candidates are already qualified by virtue of the vetting.
The assessment center compares the candidates?
The assessment center compares the candidates.
To a broader block across
to
the Commonwealth or against each other?
To each other.
And we didn't do that part last time. That they skipped over that.
But it does it extremely narrowly so once they've been qualified.
I understand, but it gives us something to look at, right?
So, I would suggest the board just conduct the interview process. I mean, that's what we're talking about. We should just conduct the interview process. It takes about a day.
Well, again, the question is, I don't deny, I think that's the end game, but the right, just as it was for the police chief. But I think, okay, what are the fundamental principles I think I'm hearing? First of all, we think we need to evaluate candidates. We have that obligation. Second of all, I think what we're hearing is we need to have some external quantitative analysis, right, to look at, like some sort of data on these candidates, comparing them to a fixed profile, which I think is what the assessment center does, that maybe a little bit lets us compare them against each other. But I think what the assessment center did more so was sort of say, yeah, they all meet or exceed this threshold, right, this level, if I recall correctly from the police chief search. So I think we need to have that done. I think what Mr. Hurst said, and I think we all agree with, which is we want the do they fit with the community part, that we think that's kind of our decision, right?
Exactly.
We think that's where we come into play. We're the ones who should look at a candidate and say they've shown they have the skill set, they've got some minimum set of background and sort of, and you know, attributes that make them be potential, but we want to be the ones that decide they're the right ones for Hopkinton.
Yeah. Just to comment on Mr. Mosier's description of the assessment center, it's my recollection that in a prior process, we sent a number of people to the assessment center, and some just came up that they weren't appropriate for the job.
Yes.
Through those evaluations. So, you know, I think it is somewhat of, it's more of a professional gauge.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm having a deja vu moment here. The conversation's a little bit different, but the topic and the concern and the process discussion is exactly what we did 6 months ago when I first came back to set up for the hiring of the police, of the fire chief. So we've already done all this, and it didn't work.
But we didn't.
Well, it didn't give the end result.
Well, okay, yeah, I'm not saying it didn't work in that we only had one candidate. I'm just saying we don't have the three candidates or the two candidates that we can compare and contrast and everything else. But to the community's point, I think there's been a lot of point made in the community about this. The process was followed that we laid out. And here we are. So why are we starting all over again? We didn't get the desired number of applicants to interview, but we didn't blow off the process and go off track. I mean, it happened the way it happened.
Yeah, but just because your argument is you run a good process, it doesn't work out, you should just say it didn't work out and just sort of move on. I don't know that I feel that way. I feel like hiring is a again, it's a strange thing.
I've seen it. Very messy process.
But again, I've seen it.
If you're on the board of a company and you're hiring, you're looking for a new CEO, and you hire a search firm, and they bring one candidate to you, do you say, and they say, we know this guy is capable, do you leave it at that? And say, okay, great.
There's a lot we could say there. Who's the candidate? How well do you know that? I mean, I don't think we need to do that at the moment, but I understand what you're saying. It's just a messy situation we're in, right? We have to acknowledge that. We're in a mess, okay?
It's awkward.
Mess. So how can we best clean up the mess? Do we suspend what we're talking about for 3 months to see what we've directed somebody to do very clearly? And how that goes. Do we say we're going to start this May 15th if we don't feel comfortable? I don't know. I'm just trying to think through options that address a very passionate...
Well, there is one option, which is put them in the chair, let them run things, as you said, and revisit this in a few months. Let everyone sort of, right, see how it goes. And I'm not a big fan of kicking cans down the road, because if you decide in 3 months, then you're basically talking about another 6 months to get it all done. So, now you've got an even more awkward situation. But it is a valid option.
I think you've put him in the chair.
I'm saying something different, though, which is now you got, you know, this sort of clear test drive, right, where in 3 months, whatever the number is, you decide, well, but now we're going to start a search or not. You can sort of do that. But let me be clear, if you get to that point, that's an even more challenging discussion.
Through the chair, question. Mr. Kamala, what was the length of the terms of the interim contract?
Yes, I actually just pointed this out to Maria. The term of the appointment runs from January 1, 2016 to March 31st, 2016. Then the town, in its sole discretion, may elect to extend the term of this contract by 2 3-month options.
So it goes through March 31st.
So through the chair, I'll make a motion.
Well, can we just talk about this first before
sure.
we go to motion
yep.
making?
Yep.
What's because I want to make sure because not everyone's had a chance.
Well, can, okay, so
go ahead.
Are you all set? Because I guess my feeling is that we did go through the process. We are where we are. But if we're going to do this again, I think there's different ideas about the role of the personnel committee. And I think the easy way to resolve that is that the board just does the process.
If I may, just to be clear for the public's sake, it's not the personnel committee. It's the fire chief
selection. I'm sorry.
Selection.
Thank you for correcting me, Norman. I apologize. The fire chief hiring committee. It would be beneficial for the board because they would have a broader background to compare candidates against should we go through this process again. And I think that it is somewhat limiting to only have 2 or 3 candidates come forward. So should we go through this again, I would suggest, and we don't have to decide tonight, but I would suggest that the board strongly consider participating in the entire interview process.
My only concern about that is the public hearing aspect of it. That means having a quorum every time. That means posting a meeting every time. That means probably doing this in public session. I don't know if this qualifies executive session discussions. Tell me if I'm wrong. You start to run into some really challenging logistics.
All
right?
The meetings were posted anyways for the fire chief hiring committee, so it would really be logistically no different.
Go ahead. Is it? Can you do it? I just don't know. Can you? This is new in my experience.
If the board so decides, the board can do that. However, my advice would be that the board seriously consider identifying a selection committee. The sole reason being that broadens the participation of the community than what you'd get if it's only the Board of Selectmen conducting the search.
Mm-hmm.
And most importantly, we also have the opportunity to leverage other technical resources such as fire chiefs in other communities to participate.
Right.
We don't have a fire chief on the board.
Right.
Yeah, I can see Mr. Mosier's point, and there's no question that doing it as he was suggesting would address some concerns, but it would create a whole bunch of other concerns. And you know, I don't think it would be appropriate. And I don't think that it would be taken well by the majority of the community, because I think the impression would be that we're trying to take sole control of the whole process, which is not anywhere close to the truth.
Well, but that is in fact what we do. We do have control over the process, and that's what we're doing is exercising that control. If we have doubts, some doubts about the committee, I think, or not even, I just think there's real value in the experience for the entire board, particularly where we feel so strongly about this position.
Well, we felt strongly about the police chief, too, and we didn't have to do this, right?
Right.
I think there's a difference between saying, at the end of the day, the selection's in our hands, and we have this obligation, and we want to fulfill it, and saying, we're going to run this entire thing ourselves, and basically not include anybody else. I mean, I do think, again, because what did we not get last time? We didn't get a lot of technical feedback. We didn't get a lot of comparative analysis, right? We didn't, and, you know, you're right. I mean, I think you're taking the issue of we didn't have people to compare against, as Mr. Catino said, and you're basically saying, well, fine, you know, then look at everybody. And I don't know that's the right answer either. I think the right answer is to talk about the issues that it seems like there's a consensus we felt strongly about, which is really, again, being able to evaluate multiple candidates using some level of data that we didn't get last time. But it's not about the board just going forth and doing this ourselves. We've never done that. We did it for one time. We did, I think, 3 consecutive CFO searches. right, two of which came out completely dry. So, I mean, we've never done this before, even when we've had more challenging searches than this.
We sat here after the police chief process wrapped up and said, this worked well.
This was great, right.
This, we all were very comfortable because we all sat in an individual room and we all had a chance to talk to the different candidates and make a decision. I don't think that was a uniform or, you know, a unanimous decision, if I recall, but it worked out great.
Yeah, and well, and we had data. We had things to look
there
at.
There he is. You know, so unfortunately, that's not where we are tonight. And that's I think, the challenge. If we had multiple candidates and we made a decision and we announced it to the community, we wouldn't be where we are today. That's for sure.
Right. I think what went wrong was we had competitive candidates withdraw.
Right. I mean, that's beyond our control.
At like the critical moment.
I agree. And that's not our fault. Wrong. Right. So again, that comes to the process was going just fine, like you said, till people bailed out the last minute.
Yeah, we had three. If we had those three candidates and we did the process that we described, we'd be in a whole different
place. We wouldn't be here.
So we could run the interim chief through an assessment center. We do have that option.
That would give some validation.
So...
Wait, can I just go to Mr. Kamala, who's got a point to make?
Yeah. Hearing all the views that the board has expressed, I think it's important also to simply reiterate, I think, the key principles behind every search that I've seen this board conduct. The first being, the town is always looking for the best qualified candidates to appear before the board. And I think what I'm hearing tonight is, how do you accomplish that goal and at the same time have a sufficient pool of candidates to evaluate? So I think the message is should be clearer in terms of the board is looking for qualified candidates to make it to whatever round the board would like to see them. Mm-hmm. The second issue is, as I said earlier, tapping into the wider experience, knowledge, and input of the community. And I think that's important. And then thirdly, this decision to hire a fire chief is the community's decision. And therefore, in terms of the assessment center is not the decider. It's simply a tool that the town uses to validate whatever decisions are made. I wanted to throw this out, and hopefully the board could use these principles to arrive at some way forward.
So through the chair to Mr. Kamalo's point about qualified candidates, I will admit that in my role, there was probably candidates that were qualified that in my estimation would not have succeeded by demeanor or personality or comments that were made. I think I made the right decision. But maybe I should have let a couple of them roll forward. But again, I felt like it was my responsibility to bring candidates forward that in conjunction with the rest of the committee, we felt could be truly successful in the position.
Okay. So here's where we find ourselves, right? So we have basically fundamentally three choices. We can say we're done, take the interim chief, make him the full chief. We can kick the can down the road and revisit this in 3 months after the interim chief's had a chance to run things for a while. Or we can just say, we've already bought this, right? We might as well just go and see what surfaces. I mean, essentially, right? It's right, start a search, see who shows up, and then reevaluate based upon the data. So those seem to be the three choices we're circling around. And I think as a board, we should just decide on which one of those we want to pursue.
So through the chair, without making a motion, I'll float an idea that we...
Can I, before you do that,
sure.
Can I just go to this side? Because I don't think either John or Todd have had sufficient chance to give thoughts. Do you have anything you want to add about any of those points? Or
I would just say that of those three options, I think options one and three are the only options where we're not opening up the possibility of doing more damage.
Okay.
And you know, I think that, you know, my personal feeling, you know, we've had a good conversation with Deputy Chief, Acting Chief Slayman. I think that he knows where he stands with us. I hope it's clear that it's in a very positive light. And I think that we should go with option three and, you know, just really solidify and create a stronger foundation underneath the decision and then move on.
What was option one?
Yep. And three.
Options one.
I didn't write them down in numbers.
Yeah, I need a whiteboard. Option one was just make Acting Chief Slayman chief. Just do it. Option two was defer. Revisit this in 3 months. He acts as acting chief. We do nothing else about looking for anybody else. We come back and revisit this in a few months with more experience on both sides. And then option three is acknowledge that we've already started this. We might as well just keep on going. I mean, see what candidates arise. Maybe there's an early review. Maybe early on the board looks at some of these candidates. And again, I'd have to figure out if there's a way to do this not too publicly, but just to keep people from being dissuaded. But maybe we do an early check, see what comes in from a candidate perspective, and then decide if it's something we want to pursue. So I know, John. I want to make sure everyone else gets a chance to talk. So.
Yeah, I like that modification that if you know we start looking and then realize that it's not producing and our interim chief is doing fabulous, we can suspend it and
call it a halt.
Go for option one.
So you slash. So you lean to okay.
That's option four.
No. That's leaves on. Yeah. That's so you lean toward four, the option right? three side of things. Just see what happens. Kind so of.
We've already gone down.
You've already started down the path. Keep on trucking. Okay. I'm not trying to annoy you, John. I just want to make sure everyone else gets a chance to say something. Brian, do you have any?
Well, I think I've put it out. You know, kind of where I'm.
You're sort of
I'm interested in. What
okay,
his
John.
Ideas.
I'm now back to you. Sorry.
Let's run the interim chief through an assessment center, pending successful completion of that. This period becomes a probationary period, and at the end of the interim contract, the board can have the decision whether to appoint him or seek new applicants.
Okay, so you threw my options out the window. So you're basically doing option two. You're basically kick the can down the road with a little bit, get a little more data, but then not decide until later. Because you're considering the March 31st date the equivalent of probationary.
Well, I mean, to be honest, I was on the committee. I've seen Deputy Slayman's performance over the years as liaison. I would be happy with appointing him, but I understand that the board wants to set him up for success. In short, it was a thorough vetting process. I don't think it would be unreasonable to have a probationary period of roughly 3 months, which we currently have. The assessment center would provide the data validation that the board is considering. At the end of that period, if there was a desire to seek new applicants, the board would have the discretion to do so.
Okay. So we have, does anybody want to talk about the option further? I mean, I think that's so.
And one quick note through the chair. I think that the chief of police had an interim period, did he not?
You mean the new
I'm
chief?
I'm sorry, a probationary period.
Let's
meet chief.
The police chief. When we hired Chief Lee, there was a probationary period.
That's correct.
I think everybody gets 180 days, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Everybody gets 180 days probationary period.
That's Mass General law, right?
I think that's just a standard thing, yeah. Everyone we've ever hired has 6 months of probationary period. Okay. So noted. Okay, so the question was, do we want to change the process, which we had basically set in motion last time, which was to start looking for new, putting together a committee, starting to look for new applicants. With the noted exception of Mr. Mosier, I think the consensus is we're just going to, let's just keep on going and see what happens. So I think, does anyone actively disagree with that? That we should just let it continue? So, right?
So
essentially the option three, Mr. Mosier is really going more toward option two with a little bit of a twist, right? Kick the can down the road proposal. I think I heard you being more towards, we've already started, let's keep going.
Well, we have, but, you know, honestly, and this isn't doesn't happen to me very often, I saw a cross-section of people in here tonight from Hopkinton that are very frustrated with this process. They don't like the quagmire we find ourselves in. I don't like it either, and I'm trying to find a way out. I still don't know what that way is, but I don't like where we are. I don't think it's fair to the community that we're not looking for a solution. We still haven't found it yet.
I think this is exactly what we're talking about right now. I think none of us like being in this position. I think what we're trying to do is find a solution, not to talk about the fact that we don't have a solution. I think the three general concepts we talked about were where we're going. And a couple minutes ago, I thought you were basically saying, let's just keep going.
I don't think we found a solution yet.
Okay.
So,
all right, if anyone has a motion to make, Chair will entertain it.
So,
I hear you.
Through the Chair, Mr. Kamau, so a probationary period is inherent in all our municipal contracts, municipal employee contracts.
Yes, we have had introductory periods for employees. However, we've also received advice from town council that a contract is a contract.
It's implied in all employment in Massachusetts, but in a contract it's a different... not implied.
I will also say that... All right. I'll also say that one must be very careful when one proposes to hire somebody with a probationary period, because that rarely has a good ending, unless, right, if it doesn't work out. It's and especially when the person's already in town and in a role. So, I you know, where you're going, Mr. Mosier, I would just say just be very thoughtful about what the end game is if it doesn't get you to where you want to get you to. Mr.
Cattino. If I may, one of the things that scares me about putting a date on it for... you know, a saying of 30 days is, or 90 days, is that I don't want to cut, as somebody mentioned it before, cut his legs out. That somebody just has to sit back and say, hey, if we can put up with him for 90 days, then he's under scrutiny again. And you know, we just charged him with being the chief, and not just warming the chair and doing his
And to that point, I mean, things can be manipulated from... within, you know, if you're given a time period like that, in a positive or negative way, either way.
I don't want to.
So, okay, so what about this? Would the board reconsider appointing Interim Chief Slayman as permanent chief pending a successful completion of an assessment center? So he's interim now. He completes the assessment, we look at the evaluation, and then we reconsider.
You know, here's my, personally, John, I sat here two and a half hours ago and told people we had a process, we believed it, and we've used it every single time, and it's about the process, not about the person. I guess having said that, I'm not going to change that view. It's about the process, it's not about, it's right, and I believe in executing the process the way we said we were going to. So I personally, at least, am not going for that. But I asked for other comments.
So through this, I'm trying to get to a solution the board can find consensus on. That's all. I'm not asking you to compromise your...
Yeah. Your moral. Well, I'm just telling you where I'm coming... No, you're not. I'm just telling you I'm not... I just tell you I just sort of made my... You know.
Yeah, but I happen to think that there's a much greater chance that we find people less suitable to the role.
But in that case, we talk about this, though. That in that case, we say, you know what? Everybody else was right. We were wrong. You know,
as the chair. If I may, you know, that's I'd go along with that if I had somebody to compare that assessment to. And that's what it really just comes down to.
It's the vacuum.
The system could be perfect, but to... compared to whom?
Well, then we're back.
And then that was my only thing. Like for a second, I was going to go. I was thinking, yeah, that's fine. But then I'm saying, however, that's where we started. Was that what are we comparing?
I think, John, I know what you're trying to do. I think the problem is the consensus that is here is not in, is not what you want. The consensus that I hear on the board is that we've already, we're in this situation, nobody likes it. We believe we've done fairly by Chief Slayman by virtue of giving him this opportunity to go forth, right, and sort of setting him up. However, the board's concern is that for a critical position in town, we feel like we owe it to have some perspective on this, right? And we, and the board just doesn't know, just has zero. We have one candidate we've seen, and we like him very much, but we just have no concept of what else is out there.
Sure.
And so I think the problem is you're trying to build a consensus that doesn't exist.
Well, so
let Brian go, and then I'll come back to you.
So I agree that, you know, what we said to folks earlier about the process is important, and that has a, and it is a process that has worked for us. It just hasn't worked for us this time. So that requires then that we consider trying to find another way, given the situation. We have to manage through situations. I mean, that's part of the job. And we have a situation now that I think requires an adjustment to our thinking based on the scenario in front of us.
But what's your adjustment?
You need, when the process
fails. The time has come, Mr. Hurtis, to actually say what you want to do and not what you don't want to do. So what do you want to do?
What a solution that works.
I know that, but that's a generality. What do you want to do about the chief? Option one, two, I mean, I'm not trying to be so definitive, but tell us what you want to do. We know we have a situation we need to fix. How do we fix it? I mean, the consensus over here, I feel pretty firmly is.
We've already
bought this one, right? It's awkward enough. Let's just keep going. Is it what I'm hearing on this side of the table? What I'm hearing this side of the table is essentially ease the chief into the full-time chief, sort of by degrees, right? And what I hear from you is we have a problem. We have to fix it. So what do you want to do?
Well, while you're thinking about that, we ended up here because in this little part of the conversation, because I suggested that the board participate fully in the interview process. If we're going to have a personnel committee, or a fire chief hiring committee
search
again, we just did that.
But that's a second order question. That's the first order question is, what do you want to do at a high level? Hire, keep looking, defer, right? And then because all that doesn't matter if the answer is hire or defer, right? If it's defer, we got tons of time to figure it out. If it's hire, it's obviously obviated. So that only matters if we're going to do it. And if we're going to do it, I think I'm hearing consistently from this side, which is keep on going, then the way we've always done this is ask the time manager to reflect on this a little bit and give us some thoughts that we can take forward, right? And so I'm not. Everything you've said is an open concept that I'm willing to discuss. I just don't think we're there yet. I want to get the first order question done because otherwise the second order question doesn't matter.
So from my perspective, given that we put out a process that we've used in the past that worked, that blew up in our face this time. Not our fault, it happened, the other people bailed. We didn't bail, we're all here, okay? But it blew up in our face. I think we have to adjust where we are now to try and move forward. And I think the way to adjust is we have an interim chief contract in place. It goes through March 31st. We do that assessment in the interim, and on March 31st, we revisit this question.
That was option five.
That would be my position to your question a few minutes ago.
So you and I are in agreement.
So you are both in agreement, defer.
I do not like kicking anything can down the road, but in this case, we have to adjust.
Well, my preference would be to appoint Deputy Slayman Chief. But beyond that, my preference would be that the board has consensus. And I think that probably the best way to reach consensus in this situation is option five.
I understand the need to compare, but we don't have that right now. But we're really going to, I think it's going to blow up even bigger if we don't take some action tonight
to adjust to the situation?
So let's. But again, I don't know that. So now I'm hearing is two on this side and two on this side, and I don't think either of these are mutually exclusive. I don't know why we can't do that, what you all just proposed. But at the same time, again, look, you know, whether do the initial stages of a search, and then do an interim analysis maybe before March 31st to decide if we want to take it forward, right? So I don't know why we don't just say, fine, by March 31st, we'll have let Chief Slayman run the store for 3 months. We'll have put him through an assessment center, so we'll have some sort of external validation. In the meantime, we'll have looked for alternative candidates, and at that point, by March 31st, we'll actually, we the board, and this is coming back to you now, so I'm just pulling this all together. We the board will look at all these candidates and say, you know what, there's enough here that we feel we have an obligation to sort of look more deeply, or none of these people look any better than the chief, who we've had in the chair now for a few months, who we like what he's doing, and we've got this validation, and we just stop it there. And there's very little energy wasted.
So that's option six.
Well sort of, I'm actually, I take it back. It's actually all of them together. This is the synthesis part, right?
I like where you're going. It's just a little different.
I think we get the perspective, you get the comfort, right? The town knows that we're doing what we said we're gonna do, which I think is important. Consistency I think is critical. But at the same time we're respecting the strongly held positions of at least a portion of the community that Chief Slayman is in fact the right person for the job and should be moving there. So I think that sort of is a little bit of a
Let me just explain where I came from, why it seems like I'm on a different side, is because when this first came back and we only had one choice, I didn't, you know, and then the whole thing blew up. The reason why I was surprised was I thought that the community, when we came down to one person and if we just rubber stamped it, we would look like we weren't doing our job, and then when it blew up and this whole quagmire that we're in, it's I just want everybody to know that we're just trying to do our job and do our due diligence.
So
this is where we're at.
Well, through the chair. So question for you, John. So is your feeling in moving this forward that the community wouldn't view you have done your due diligence versus you feeling that Interim Chief Slayman would be a good fit for for Hopkinton as the permanent chief?
You know, I'm not going to let you ask him that question because I think you're putting him on the spot a little bit. I don't want to do that. I don't have to let him I don't have to let you because I think you're playing for points.
Just ask the question.
I know, but it's not a fair question.
You don't have
John.
To let him answer.
It's not a fair question. It's a leading question.
It is a fair question.
It isn't. It's not because it's basically making it sound. I mean, you're not asking in an open fashion. You're asking in a basically. That's sort of the equivalent of the classic sort of have you stop beating your wife kind of thing is what that sounded like to me the way I heard it come out. I think you can't do that. I think here's what I think is most important is that whenever we pick a chief, whoever that chief may be, it's done by all of us in a enthusiastic, positive fashion as opposed, right? So that's actually the topic we haven't talked about. What matters at the end? What matters at the end is we all pick a chief that we all say, for all of our varied and different reasons, this is absolutely the right person. And it's not because a bunch of people came in and yelled at us and mm-hmm. told us how dumb we are.
Right.
It's because we actually, Let me finish. What I think matters is that we get five votes who say, yeah, I'm here. I think what I'm hearing is, and I respect you for trying to create a consensus around all these different test drives. I think what I feel is everybody has their own different reasons for not being that vigorous yes yet. And what I want to do is I want to get us to the point as soon as we can, but more importantly, you know, properly, where we can all do that. And so what I think I'm hearing is where I just was a minute ago, which is, I think that's going to take a little bit of time, and it's going to take a little bit of data, and I think it's the only way to go about it. And so what I would really like the board to do is I'd really like the board to keep Chief Slayman on the March 31st deadline, look to do an assessment center on Chief Slayman, check in with him constantly. In the meantime, I think it's important that we satisfy the the respect or desires of our other, of our colleagues and all of us, I think the obligation we have to do some level of due diligence. So we go out, we look for resumes, we maybe do a little bit of sifting, and then in March the board revisit this, and we'll have the perspective that I think some of us feel we need. I think again we'll have the experience with Chief Slayman that I think some of us feel we need, and I think at that point we could look to get a more vigorous consensus about where to go.
I'll come back to you, John.
As we're wrapping up this conversation right now, can we also in our future meetings get more information on the assessment center? I'm not sure if it's having someone from the assessment center come in here or us getting documentation. You know, I'll be honest, you know, I've seen some of the results from the assessment center. In every case, it's been across multiple people who are going there. So you have this one to compare to that one, to compare to that one, and you see the different aspects that are tested. But one thing I'm unclear on, and I'd like to get more information on, is for the various disciplines that they are assessing, you know, is there, you know, a magic line that says, this person passed, but this grade, this person got this grade, and they didn't pass? Or is it more of, you know, yeah, you know, some people get in the 90s, some people get in the 80s, some people get in the 70s, and yeah, there, you know, there are chiefs who are in the 70s, and there are chiefs who are in the 60s. I don't know, so I'd
so
like more
need
information.
So we're going
to
need to understand what
that.
We're looking at, too.
Exactly.
Okay. Back to you, John.
So Ben, John, I apologize. I wasn't trying to leave you if it appeared that way. I wasn't trying to back you into a corner to say something that may be unpopular. I was honestly just trying to understand.
I can explain to the chair.
So we'll just back up. My motivation wasn't to pin you in a corner.
Okay. So. What it was if we ended up with one candidate and that candidate wasn't a beloved member of the community that everybody came out and yelled at us about, and we were left with that one, and we had just said, okay. Then that community would have come out and said, how dare you guys just wait till the last person to come out? You know, and that's the part that I, you know, I didn't expect this barrage. I thought that we were doing the right thing. And I still think we're doing the right thing.
That's what I was trying to get at.
As much as he's beloved by me, that we stick to this process, because this could have been a whole different position, down to one candidate, and that candidate not have that support. And we would have been looked at just as damningly, and it's hard for me. It's friends, family, and everything. I'm not invited to houses and stuff now because of this, and it's not easy. I don't take it lightly.
So through the chair, I'd like to make a motion that the board direct Norman Camallo and Maria Casey to repost together candidates. That the board investigate and have the option to perform an assessment center between now and March 31st. And at the end of the interim chief's interim contract, the board determine whether or not to seek new candidates.
Yeah. Before, I think, rather than just say that, because there's extensions, I would just say before March 31st.
Prior to March 31st, friendly amendment accepted.
Okay. Well, it's just a motion. Okay, so we have a motion on the table. Need a second.
Can we just clarify what that motion one more time?
I was still recovering from my talk.
In accordance with suggestion 7.B.
Yeah, 7.B, subsection A, revision C. To direct town manager and human resources, director of human resources, to repost together candidates' information.
So we're going to repost.
Yep. To investigate, and at the board's option, perform an assessment center. For the interim chief.
Assessment center of the interim chief.
And then prior to March 31st, determine whether or not to, what did I say before?
To determine,
whether or not to pursue
a full interview process for a new chief.
Prior to March 31st.
So can I ask a question of the motion? So if you're going to repost, but you're not necessarily going to act on those repostings until sometime prior to March 31st. Is that what you're saying?
Right.
No, I'm saying by March, before March 31st. The reason we said March 31st is
whether
that's
we
when
were going to
is up.
Act on those.
So a repost, gather some resumes, and then by
to evaluate.
To evaluate, and then by March 31st, we're going to decide whether we're going to act or not on those resumes.
Right. And in between there, determine if we want to do an assessment center.
Second.
Motion and a second. Further discussion? Questions, comments, thoughts?
So is there an assessment center, or is that
if,
we're thinking
if,
about
if
this?
We want one, yes. I know Mr. Sestari mentioned
okay.
investigating it.
We make it. I think there's a firmly held view we should have an assessment center. Can we just?
Yeah. Okay. Two. I'm revising my motion to perform an assessment center with Interim Chief Sleeman prior to March 31st.
That was my understanding. So it's in my second.
Got it. Okay. So we're repost, gather data, do an assessment center on the chief, get some quantitative feedback, revisit all this. Probably in March, because it's going to take some time to get the resumes and all, and then decide if we want to go restart a full interview process.
So just so that expectations and actions are appropriate, for Acting Chief Sleiman, is it assumed that he does not have to officially put his name into that search pool because he's being considered through the assessment center process?
I think before we do anything, we will confirm with him that he still wants the job after having filled the job.
Okay. So one thing that people should be aware of, though, is that, you know, processes like this and the actions that happen within town and in a situation like this where we have an interim chief, an acting chief, I'm not sure what the better terminology is for us, but Steve is fire chief over there right now. And then we're saying we're going to get resumes, and at the same time, we're putting him through the assessment center. That kind of thing, that word gets around, and it often affects whether people will apply or not. And, you know, I mean, I had my father, and I've had uncles who, you know, applied for positions, and similarly to our search, where it got down to the final three candidates or the final four candidates, they look around and see that, you know, they were the only outsider who was there, and then they said, you know, it's not worth my time driving to, you know, this section of the state or whatever to go through the horse and pony show. Mm. So we just have to be aware of what the perception may be externally. And if people are comfortable with that, then comfortable
yeah.
with that.
Yeah, I feel I just think it's sort of the side effect of an imperfect process here. You know, we're trying to salvage this.
There's no good answer. You know,
it's coming in sideways on fire.
Mm-hmm. A quick Google of fire chief in Hopkinton, and I think all that'll come up whether we do this or not. You know, they're going to know that the chief is there. So,
okay. We have a motion. We have a second. We have any further discussion? Everybody clear on what we're voting? It's been a long night. Okay. So all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Present not voting. That's unanimous. Ms. Kamal, any questions about that?
I think I got the three components.
Okay,
of the
let's get it moving. Motion. Let's go. Good. All right. Liaison reports. Mr. Herr.
I have nothing to report.
Okay. Mr. Mosier.
I'm going to skip the fire report for tonight. I will say both Mr. Herr and I have been alternating on attending the school committee's budget hearings and budget meetings. And I will say to date, the school seems to be extremely budget conscious, and the moves they're making across departments and across schools seem to be done in a synergistic, complementary manner that is consistent with the strategic plan. So far, I've been very impressed with what I've seen.
Agree.
Okay.
And complimentary with an I or an E?
Pardon?
Can I just jump on that real quick? There's another meeting Thursday evening, January 7th, in the middle school. I cannot attend. I'm traveling on business.
As am I.
Just an FYI.
So if somebody else wants to make that meeting, that would be great.
7 o'clock?
Yeah. And then I would still like to revisit the makeup of the Green Committee and their mission and that sort of thing at some point in the near future.
I'll try to go. Remind me about the school committee thing when I'm done. Okay. Any other liaison reports?
No, I'm good.
Mr. Catino?
Nothing at this time.
Mr. Sestari?
Charter Review Commission, initial emails went out. Getting people organized. We're supposed to meet for the first time next week. Hasn't been determined exactly when yet, but it's looking like it's probably going to be Thursday night next week. And that first meeting will primarily be organizational. But I think everybody acknowledges and understands that we need to move quickly on this.
Okay. Mr. Kamalo, Town Manager's Report.
Included in your packet tonight is a listing of the capital articles that have been presented to the CIC. I believe there's a meeting scheduled later this week where the CIC will actually be taking our positions. And further, as we've done in past years, the town manager's draft comprehensive budget for FY17 will include a review and analysis of the capital projects and how they potentially could be funded.
Okay. Any questions? Okay, go.
Second issue is the request by the owner of an affordable unit at 13 Patriots Boulevard to lease that unit for a specified period of time. The current owner has shared with the principal planner her medical situation, which requires her to be outside the country for a period of up to 2 years.
Wow.
We believe this is a credible request. And as we've done in the past, we are offering the board two options. The board can, at its own discretion, approve this request or deny the request. Included in your packet were sample letters, one approving and the other one is a deny letter. What it does for the town is it continues to preserve the unit as an affordable unit. We will have the appropriate tools in place to ensure that whoever is renting the apartment does meet the affordable housing unit requirements.
Okay. Ms. Kamal, can you talk about the staff recommendation?
Yeah. The staff recommendation is that the board approve the request with the conditions that are stipulated in the letter included.
Right, which would be for a year plus, so not 2 years, just 1 year.
Yeah. Our thinking was it could be 2 years, but at the we will require regular monitoring and reviews by the principal planner.
So staff recommendation is approval for a year with 5 conditions, which basically just go to making sure it stays designated as affordable.
Yes.
Okay. Questions from the board on the rental request? Mr. Herr.
As long as there's somebody in town hall assigned to monitor and make sure it stays affordable, I'm fine.
Mr. Catino?
No, I'm all set.
Mr. Mosier?
I'm good.
And Mr. Sestari? So, I guess Chair will entertain a motion to approve the rental request for 13 Patriots Boulevard for a period not to exceed 1 year with the conditions stipulated in the memo from the principal planner. Which I guess I'll just read. The rent shall not exceed carrying costs of the properties determined by CHAPA. Any rent above those costs shall be returned to the municipality's Affordable Housing Trust Fund at the completion of the lease. Any renter shall be income eligible and certified by CHAPA. Any request for extension of the lease term must be made in writing at least 90 days prior to the end of the lease term so that the town can review the previous year and determine if another year is warranted. And the homeowner shall furnish the town with the name and contact and information of any renter.
Second.
We have a second. Do we have any further discussion, questions? All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, present, not voting. That's unanimous. That's it for the town manager's report. Future board agenda items. Mr. Catino.
No, all set.
Mr. Herr.
Downtown revitalization and the intersection. Haven't heard anything about it in the last few weeks. Interested in what's going on with
the need for land to make the intersection work?
Quick update for the board. The town's consultants are actually, as we speak, redesigning the intersection based on the parameters laid out by the board at your last meeting. We have also been in contact with Mass DOT regarding the changes that the board discussed, including the bike lane, the redesign of the realignment of the intersection. And also, I had a very open discussion with the Chamber of Commerce in which they gave town staff very clear feedback, but most importantly also offered their assistance in terms of participating more actively in educating the public about this project.
If I could just follow on, not so much a question, but at the meeting where we discussed this, I think it was a couple of meetings ago, we asked that we get feedback from town council about what process needs to begin to line up for the land accessed by the community. Am I saying that well? I'm tired here. I thought we were going to get some information from Mr. Mayeres about what would need to happen, and I don't think I've seen that yet.
Yeah, we've posed that question to town council. He is considering the issue.
Yeah. Okay.
You good on agenda items? Mrs. Sestari. Did I go to your edits? Mm-hmm. Mr. Mosher.
Never made that mistake.
So two things. I've had a lot of people ask me what town hall is going to do with the departure of Jamie Helen. I'm sure there's a plan in place, but maybe in the next town manager's report, you just want to have something about what you're going to do about that position. That would be one. And then the other is, this isn't defensive, and as I think someone pointed out earlier, we've all been through worse, but there appears to be a perception that we don't listen to the community, that we're not out there enough at events and things like that. I don't know what we do to counter that. I know we all go to what we can. We come to these meetings in addition to other liaison meetings and public events. I really don't have a way to get a message out. Obviously, nobody will ever share the same perspective unless they've been on the board. But I think it's just something that we should be aware of. I don't really have an answer for it. I know for myself, I'll just keep doing what I'm doing because it's pretty much all I can do. You know, I don't have a whole lot of time left at the end of the day. I don't think any of us do. But I know we've all gone through decisions where we've lost sleep that maybe it appears as though we're, I don't know, maybe cavalier or we don't give it thought. But I know I spend an awful lot of my time outside of this building thinking about what goes on in town, as I know all of my peers do. So it's not really an agenda item, I guess. Just more of an observation, and I'm sure it's one that every board that's ever sat up here has had to deal with.
All right.
I said my piece.
Okay. Thank you. That's it on the agenda. Chair, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Motion second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. President voting. That's unanimous. Good night, everybody.